Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the first session of your financial management. Allow me to very briefly introduce myself. I am ACCA Shilpi Jain. I did my ACCA back in 2009 from the UK, wherein I did my full-time ACCA training. Thereafter, I've been involved with various corporate trainings. So that is about myself. And I've been teaching this financial management paper for the last 6 years now. And we've had very good results. But what is extremely important is your involvement in the subject. At the end of the day, it is you who have to go and give the exam. So I will be giving my 100% commitment. I also require the same 100% commitment from yourself. The sessions have been scheduled for weekends only to be able to facilitate you guys to be able to join in the sessions. So please make sure that you're joining in the sessions, in the live sessions, asking me your doubts live then and there. And also, I'm also available thereafter. We've created this WhatsApp group in which I am also there. So you can shoot in your queries at any point of time. Just follow the regime which I will be leading you through towards your next June 21 attempt for ACCA for financial management. Now, before I actually introduce the subject, let's very quickly have the basic housekeeping rules for this online class. So we are all connected through Zoom. I request everyone to please make use of the chat box option wherein you can send in your queries. So I'm just putting in the chat box option here. So this is your chat box option wherein we can just type in your queries. The reason why I'm asking you to type in your queries is so that I can repeat the query for everyone to understand, and then I will answer your query as well. So before I proceed, anybody has any doubts regarding how the class is going to be scheduled? Any doubts? As a basic, basic rule of the class is that you have to interact with me. So if I'm asking you a question, you have to get back to me with an answer of whether you have understood the concept or do you require certain more clarity in it. I'll be more than happy to provide more examples, more question practice. Everything will be done as long as you are with me in the classes, right? So Manish asks that, will you be provided with the notes? So yes, Manish, I have created these notes for myself, which are shown on the screen to you. These will be provided to you in the PPT format. So yes, notes will be provided to you as part of your backup on your LMS and also via email on each one of your respective IDs. So as soon as we we finish off one weekend session, in the next week, you'll be receiving the notes of it as well. And the classes will also be uploaded as part of the backup. And remember, to be able to pass, to have your ACCA pass guarantee, you have to join in the live session. That is how you will be utilizing yourself and making the best use of these classes, because there is no training like an online training, which wherein you are involved and connected with me live itself, right? Okay, so are we good to go ahead? Let me just very quickly now introduce the subject as well to you. So, okay. Everybody able to see my screen? My screen is visible? Right, wonderful. So let's just very quickly go on a full screen mode. Right, so the financial management paper, that is the F9 paper, the last paper of the applied skills level in your ACCA papers. Now, after this paper, you're going straight into the professional level, right? So extremely important is to understand that this paper is right on the verge of your professional level papers. So the skill that you will be requiring is going to be similar to what a professional level paper of ACCA is going to require. So you're going to develop the skills which are going to take you right from becoming a student to now becoming a professional. So the way you're not, you know, just writing your answers, remember this F9 paper is not only just about number crunching. It will not only be just about making the calculations, but it will be extremely important to be able to write supportive notes talking about these numbers, to be able to interpret these numbers. So that is the professional level skill that we are going to learn in our F9 paper. So very quickly, let's have a look at what the subject looks like. So the subject, the aim of the subject is to develop skills and knowledge expected of a finance manager in relation to, so there are broad categories in which a financial manager in any organization works. So they're going to be talking about everything related to money, right? Where the money is going to come from, where the money is going to be invested. And once the money is invested, you've made use of this money to earn more money. What do you do with this money? Do you reinvest it somewhere in more projects? Do you give it out as dividends to the shareholders? So all of these are broad areas of the subject that we will be talking about, right? Now, very quickly, before I actually, you know, go deeper into the subject, I want you to tell me of what do you understand by the term financial management, which is the name of the subject itself. So just what is, you know, your understanding of what do you think that we are going to be digging into now? So tell me your understanding of the subject. What do you understand by financial management? What do you understand by the term financial management? If you are tomorrow employed as a finance manager in XYZ Limited, what would be your key responsibility areas? So just, you know, any thoughts you have on it. Remember, in the classes, whenever I'm asking questions, it doesn't have to be necessarily the right answer. Whether it is right or not, or, you know, if you anyways answer the incorrect question, I am there to be able to support you and guide you with the correct answer. But very important is that each one of us actually start interpreting and actually start, you know, just giving away your thoughts to each other. Okay, so I have some inputs from the class. Heman says, manage the finances, that is the money. How the company uses the money to enhance the wealth as well as profitability. Absolutely right. Wealth of whose? Ultimately, if there is an organization, who owns the organization? It is the shareholders, right? So we are all working towards, as a finance manager, to be able to maximize the shareholders' wealth. So that is one of our major criteria as a finance manager that we have to be looking into. Good answer, Heman. So what else? Surbhi says, management of finance for wealth maximization. Wonderful answer, Surbhi. Push says, management of inflows as well as outflow of cash. Very important. Where the money is going to come from, where the money is going to be invested, where the money is going to be allocated. So inflow process and then outflow of cash as well. So yes, extremely good answer. Vaishnavi says, managing the source of finance. Yes, so where is it going to come from? So yes, that is one aspect of the role of the financial manager. So good answer, Vaishnavi. Naveen says, cash, expenses, profitability. So yes, everything, you know, these would be few of the critical areas which the finance manager, which is you now, will be looking at. So where is the cash going to coming, you know, going to come in from? Where is the outflow happening? So where is the, what are the expenses happening, and what is happening to the profitability of the organization? Nandu says, managing the funds of the business effectively. Yes, so all about finances, all about being able to manage the funds of the organization. Akash says, investments as well as disinvestment decisions. Good point, Akash, because as a finance manager, you need to be able to evaluate where the money that you've arranged for is being allocated, right? Where is it basically being invested? Apart from that, you also need to find out where is it, you know, what are the sources wherein you need to probably take out your investment. So that is called disinvestment. So pulling out of the investment. So why do you think we should be able to, you know, we should be talking about disinvestment in areas which are probably not giving us sufficient returns that we are looking at? disinvestment in areas which are probably, you know, because of government licensing and all, we are unable to operate now. Disinvestment in areas which are probably not giving us the desired results that we expected in the first place. So let's just pull out investment from that genre. So yes, it also talks about disinvestment. The amount of capital required. Yes, so how much capital is required and how and where are you going to invest this capital? So yes, that's right. So very good answers, everyone. I'm extremely, you know, delighted to know that you all have at least some idea of what we are basically heading into. Definitely now that we, you know, enter into the subject, we talk about the paper, we talk about the subject. Slowly and gradually, I'm going to take you through all of these areas that we've just done, we've just discussed regarding the subject. And definitely there is going to be much more and much deeper understanding of what is it that you all will be required to do as a finance manager tomorrow in your organization when you get employed, right? Everybody okay with it? Okay, so yes, definitely this is the last paper of your applied skills level. So there will be some brought forward knowledge that you will be taking across here, which is coming from your management accountancy paper of your applied knowledge level. And one up level to this is going to be your AFM paper, which is your advanced financial management paper from the professional level paper of ACCA, right? Everybody okay with it? So we all understand what sort of brought forward knowledge will we be expected to have in this paper and what more, what is like the next level after the subject at the professional level, which you may choose as one of the options in your professional level ACCA exams, right? Everybody okay? Okay, now very important to set the expectations right in the first place, because if you as a student understand that what is it that the examiner, the examining team expects from you in this paper, when the expectations are, you know, 100% clear from day one itself, you know what exactly you're required to groom yourself for the next 2 months in which we will be studying this paper before you actually sit down for your attempt in June 21 towards your FM paper. So very clear on clear, that is why I want to make sure that everybody, each one of you understands that what is the examining team's expectations from you as a student to be able to give you a pass, which is 50 marks out of your 100 marks to be able to clear this paper. So let's set the expectations right from the day one itself. So very clearly, like I told you, FM paper is not just only going to be about performing calculations. It is going to be one level up than that. So not only are you required to perform calculations, you're also required to interpret these calculations. You're also required to comment on these calculations. You're also required to understand and give your recommendations as to what do you think and why do you think this is the right, probably, you know, the investment option that the company has. So yes, very important is to set right the calculations. So perform calculations as well as comment on calculations which you will be providing. Perform critical abilities in the sense that you should be able to, you know, interpret these numbers. So what does a positive NPV really mean? What does it interpret? What do I do with it? How do I make my decisions as a finance manager? So all of these would be your, what you have to learn as part of your FM training. Demonstrate understanding of the syllabus. Very important. See, this is literally an international qualification that you're pursuing. You have to go one level up. You have to be able to demonstrate the fact that you understand the syllabus, the nitty-gritties of the syllabus. You understand what is it that is required of you from this paper. Use question information. Very important, very basic level expectation. But sometimes the students actually, you know, kind of ignore what the question is saying. So please don't do that. If the examiner has put in an effort of writing, a question, pay due respect to the question as well as the information given in the question. One very critical thing here is to understand that when we are reading the question and reading the requirements of the question, we should focus on the verb of the question. What is it exactly that the examiner is asking us to do? Do we have to, describe something? Do we have to analyze something? Do we have to discuss something? Do we have to just calculate something? So very important is to understand and do exactly what the requirement of the question asks for, right? Everybody okay with the expectations? We now understand that what is it that we will be grooming ourselves for the next 2 months towards this paper, right? Any doubts so far? Please always feel free to type in your doubt in the chat box. If there's anything that you want me to reiterate, if there's anything that you want me to inform you, I'll be more than happy to do so. The only thing required is that I should be able to understand that, okay, this is something which I probably need to repeat, and I'll be more than happy to do so. I do not like to go ahead till the time the concept is 100% clear with the entire class, right? Everybody understands the expectations of the paper? Everybody understands the broad paper that we are entering into? Wonderful. Great. Right, now that we know, okay, this is what we are, entering into, let's now very quickly understand the exam as well. What is it that is going to be your financial paper going to look like? So the exam in itself, just reduce this as well, yeah. So the exam in itself is going to be a 100-marker exam. It's going to have, all compulsory questions. So there will be obviously no choice given to you in the exam. It is going to contain both computational as well as discursive elements. So there is going to be some number crunching required. There is also going to be certain calculations as well as discussions regarding what is it that the paper is asking for. The same question is going to adopt a scenario, or it's going to be like a case study approach that we always follow in ACCA papers. So if you've given any other ACCA paper so far, you already know the approach that ACCA follows. It's going to be a scenario based. It's going to have a question given to you, which is like talking about XYZ company, what's happening in the company, and this is what the company is probably looking at. If it's a working capital management question, we'll be talking about that. Okay, these are the inflows and the outflows. What do you reckon that, what sort of cash budgets is the company required to prepare? What is the working capital cycle that the company has to maintain? What is the EOQ cycle that is going to work best for the inventory level? Obviously, you don't understand these terms as of now, but yes, every scenario is going to ask you certain related questions to the scenario as well. The exam is going to be a computer-based exam, so which means you will be writing your questions and your answers on the computer. This has been the form for ACCA papers for quite some time, but again, I'm reiterating that there is no pen and paper, in the exam. So what we all have to do is just get rid of any pen and paper if you are having it with you. No pen and paper allowed in my class. What you have to do is to solve all questions on an Excel. What you have to do is to look at question practice on Excel. You have to look at Word document wherein you will be looking at what is it that, how do we discuss the questions? How do we talk about these questions? How do we talk about these numbers? So no pen and paper in the exam, only have to work upon Microsoft Excel and Microsoft Word, because the scenario, the paper is going to have a platform which is going to be similar to your Microsoft Word and your Microsoft Excel. I will be taking you through this computer-based exam practice platform of ACCA so that you are familiar with what is it that the exam is going to look like and how are we going to solve questions on this CBE platform. Extremely important is that we do lots and lots of question practice on the platform itself, so that in the exam, while you're attempting the real, you know, the live exam, there are absolutely no surprises for you. So along with computational skills, along with discursive skills that you have to develop, extremely important is to be familiar on the platform itself, that how the exam is going to look like, where is it that you have to attempt your question, right? So I'll be taking you through the CBE exam platform just to familiarize you all, and absolutely no pen and paper in the class now, right? Right, so what are the skills that will be required towards your F-time paper? So the skills required is going to be, like I said, some brought forward knowledge from your management accounting paper. Calculations have to be absolutely clear. Please do not try and mess up, you know, do not try and upset the examiner. Make calculations, make clear calculations. Make logical structure towards your towards the formats that you're following. So very important is to be, you know, trying to make the life of the examiner easy. If you try and do that from day one itself, I'm giving, you know, crisp layouts, I'm giving clear calculations, I'm marking my calculations well, the examiner finds it so easy for the examiner to check your paper. And when that happens, definitely the examiner is happy in awarding you marks as well, right? What else do you think is required for your F9 paper? Definitely we have to be able to interpret the data. We should be able to explain the management accounting techniques as well as discuss their application to the question itself. You should be able to apply the skills in a practical manner, that, okay, this is the theory that I've learned, but do I just stick to mugging up? The mugging up learn, you know, approach, the retain and reproduce approach, the rote learning approach definitely doesn't work in ACCA. It's a very, very practical qualification. You should be able to apply the skills in an extremely practical manner. Very important is to understand that you should be able to link your knowledge, which you have gained in the classes, to the scenario which is provided to you. Do not just provide hypothetical answers. Do not just provide theoretical answers. What you are required to do is to be able to practically interpret in relation to the company, to the scenario which has been provided to you. So that is something which is extremely important, right? Everybody okay with it? Any doubts? Any doubts? Okay, wonderful. Right, so before I actually proceed, let me type down the books that we will be following. I thought somebody would ask me this question, but we'll be following the BPP workbook plus the practice and revision kit. I'm writing it down for you so that you're all able to understand the books which you need to buy. So BPP workbook as well as the practice and revision kit applicable towards your June 21 exam is required. Now, just in case a few of you do not have the books on you as of now, you can reach out to the team at VG Learning. So I am just sharing the concerned person's number with you. So this is the concerned person you can reach out to buy your physical books, to buy your ebooks, whatsoever you require. But this is something that you have to purchase. I will be providing notes. I have some questions prepared on, you know, as well, which we will be looking at. But extremely important is for you all to be able to have this book on you as well. Let me just show the books to you. Let me just see what portion of my screen is visible. Okay, so this is the workbook. Is it visible to everyone? I hope everybody is able to see the workbook. And then this is the practice and revision kit. applicable in your June attempt. So please purchase these books, get in touch with the number provided, or you can drop in an email as well. So just in case, you know, is not available. ACCA help desk at vglearningdestination.com is the ID on which you can go and purchase these books. You can directly purchase these books from the VG Learning website as well. So that is also one of the options which is available to you. But yes, having these books on you is extremely important. You can go and purchase an ebook as well, or if you're still comfortable with physical books being on you, physical books are also available. But yes, you need to have the books on you, right? Everybody okay? Okay, so now that we know the skills that we are requiring for this F9 paper, let's quickly dive into the subject area, the syllabus area. What all aspects will we be learning towards in your F9 paper? So yes, there are many parts towards your syllabus. It is broken down into up till part G of your syllabus. Why I have written it a little jumbled up way is in terms of the important or the weightage of these subject syllabus areas. So very important, just like the most important subject area is going to be your part D of your paper, of your subject, which is talking about investment appraisal. Extremely important. Next in ranking is your part C, which talks about working capital management. Up next is going to be part E of the syllabus area, which talks about business finance. Then part F, which talks about business valuation. Part G then, which talks about risk management. And part A and part B thereafter, which talks about financial management function broadly and the financial management environment. So this is how you can, you know, study your syllabus area in terms of the weightage. Now, this weightage is not given by ACCA. This is something which only I have, you know, put across because of my experience over the last so many years of teaching the financial management paper. But extremely important is for you to have 100% coverage of the entire syllabus. Why I've put them down in this hierarchy is for you to understand that where these questions are going to be. So your part C of the syllabus is going to be most definitely coming in from investment appraisal or working capital management, which obviously has like more weightage. Can we just use your notes and practice and revision kit? Will it not be enough to clear? Well, yes, Akash, the notes and the practice and revision kit is something which is like definitely required. In the class itself, I will be making use of the workbook to solve all the questions which are given on the workbook. So in the class, we'll basically be going through the entire workbook. Why I'm telling you to purchase it so that you actually have something hands-on ready with you, just in case you want to refer back to a question, right? Because the question and the solution that we'll be doing in the class will be shown here on the screen, but you will not have a physical copy of the question on you unless you actually purchase the book. Workbook is the study material. Workbook is basically like your textbook. Workbook is your textbook. It's just now called a workbook because it has incorporated questions to be practiced within them as well. I will just take you through the workbook and the concept of it so you will better understand. Everybody able to see and hear me? Okay, great. Right, so this is how the syllabus area has been broken down. That does not mean that part A and part B or part G probably is not important. They are extremely important. Why? Because most of your two marker questions, remember, you only need 50 marks to be able to pass your paper, right? So these are sub syllabus areas wherein you will be getting tested maximum on like a two marker question coming in from these areas. But extremely important for you to be able to have a good knowledge of these syllabus areas to be able to pass your paper as well. Is everybody okay with it? So we all now understand that 100% weightage is given. Can you please show the books again? Okay, Hemant, sure. Let me just show you the books again. And let me just see whether it is visible. So let me just open up the thumbnails. Okay, so there you are. This is your practice and revision kit. I hope it's visible. I think it's a little pixelating for some reason. Probably because it's a white on a white background. What I'll do, I'll click pictures of these books and send in the WhatsApp group as well, right? So I'll be clicking pictures of the books and sending in the WhatsApp group as well so that you all know what you basically need to buy. Okay, are there any negative marking scenarios? No, there is no negative marking. So when we actually come down to your MCQs, the Section A questions, so this will be part of the training for that, that because there is no negative marking and supposedly you're like absolutely, you have no idea about what the question is talking about. You're like, you have like zero knowledge about it. Worst come first scenario, just do a random, just mark randomly any option out of the four options given, because you at least then have like a 1/4 probability, that is a 25% probability of the answer being correct. Right, Hemant? So that will be, I will be telling you all of this as part of your skill for you towards handling your MCQ questions. Right? Great. I'm giving FM as the first exam of ACCA after exemptions. And I'm also working. Any suggestions, ma'am? How are we gonna study? Okay, Shweta, absolutely. I understand that a lot of you might be coming via the exemptions route. So this like could be your first paper of ACCA. Do not worry, Shweta. Just follow whatever advice I'm giving in the class. Just follow that. And I'm sure you'll be able to pass. And it's because of students like you who are working that the classes have been weekends, so that you're all able to join in the session, utilize these sessions to the maximum, and really, so that you know what really you need to do towards passing your FM paper. So don't worry, Shweta, I'm there to guide you and I'm there to tell you what all you need to cover to be able to pass your paper. Just the only thing that is really required from your end is a sincere effort in doing what I'm telling you to do. Right, Shweta? And okay with everyone? Great. Okay. So now let's have a look at the exam. Is it compulsory to clear F5 to F8 to exam for attempting F9 exams? No, Sahil. ACCA gives you complete flexibility to be able to choose any paper within one level that you are. So here at the applied skills level, you can choose any paper in any order. So you can definitely go ahead with FM paper before, you're actually reaching out to it. Sakshi, in case you're not joined on the WhatsApp group, this is the number that you need to reach out to so that you are joined in the WhatsApp group as well, right? Just in case all of you are not in the live group or in the live FM group for June 21, which we've created, this is the number that you need to reach out to and the concerned person will add you in the WhatsApp group as well. Because from time to time, I will be sharing a lot of value adding, notes, technical articles, other things which will be required for you to be able to pass your paper. So not just during the classes, apart from this, during the weekdays as well, we'll be constantly in touch with each other and, following what is required, right? Okay, now let's have a look at what the exam structure is going to look like. So the exam is going to be a 3-hour exam. So the time that you have to appear on the system once you actually press on start exam, you're going to be timed for the next 3 hours till you for you to be able to complete your paper. In the next 3 hours, as soon as your 3 hours expire, your exam is going to automatically end, just in case you haven't ended it yourself prior to that, right? That is the time allowed. So how many marks do we have? How many marks do we have? We've got a 100 marker question, right? 100 marks paper, and we've got 3 hours. Any idea how much time do you have per per mark really? Tell me, I want the class to tell me, what is the time that you have to be able to attempt per mark? So 100 marks and 118 minutes. So 1.8 minutes per mark, 1.8 minutes per mark is what you have towards your ACCA paper, right? So do not means just do not overspend anything more than that. So you've got 180 minutes, that is your 3 hours, and you've got 100 marks to attempt. So 1.8 minutes per mark is what you have to give to a question. So if it's a 2-marker question, you're only going to spend 3.6 minutes on it and nothing beyond that. As soon as your 3.6 minutes are over, drop dead the question, move on to the next question. Because very often some students come back and say that, you know, they were not able to attempt the entire question. They were not able to attempt the entire exam itself. Why? Why do you think that happens? That happens because of poor time management. So this time management skill is something which is extremely important, not just only for your FM paper, but for all ACCA papers. So just start getting into the habit of maintaining and giving due respect to time from day one itself. So remember, towards your 10 marker questions, I'm not going to spend anything more than 18 minutes on it. And if in case I've not been able to finish the question within the stipulated 18 minutes, what we're going to do? We're going to drop dead the question, move on to the next question. Remember, if you were not able to finish it in the next 18, in the 18 minutes which were allocated to you, it is not worth spending more time on it. You just rather go to the next question and gain the easy marks from the next question so that it increases the probability of you to be able to pass your ACCA paper, right? Everybody okay with it? Great. Okay, so this 3 hours that we have, we've got 3 sections in our FM paper that we have to finish in these 3 hours. So we've got section A questions, which are going to comprise of 15 objective test questions of 2 marks each. These are objective test questions, which means either it could be an MCQ, so you have to select the right option, or you have to do very small calculation and then submit it you have to submit the correct answer for it. Remember, in this objective test questions, you will be required to make certain calculations, but these calculations for your section A questions are not going to be marked. So you need not beautify these calculations. There is going to be a scrap paper which is available to you. If you're attempting for the paper in the exam center, a physical rough paper will be given to you wherein you can just quickly make these calculations and drop dead the answer in the computer. Or if you're sitting for the exam remotely because of COVID situation, then you will be given a scrap papers, option available on the computer itself, wherein you can make these calculations and just directly jump on to the main system and write down your correct option. I think there's a query. Calculators allowed. Yes, Surbhi, calculators are allowed in ACCA exams. So there is an inbuilt calculator functionality in your CBE exam itself. I will be taking you through the platform. So calculators are inbuilt in the platform itself. So that is something which is there already. Also, you're allowed to carry physical calculators to your centers or use it during your remote exams, whatsoever you're appearing for. Scientific calculators are also allowed as long as the calculator doesn't have the functionality to store information, right? So that is something which is allowed. I'm not carrying it on me today, but in tomorrow's class, I will try and show you one of the calculators which is allowed by ACCA. So just in case you want to buy a calculator, you can definitely go in for that model as well, right? Okay, so section A, 2-marker questions, 15 marks or 15 questions of 2 marks each. So that makes it a total of 30 marks. Remember, the easiest 30 marks that you can ever have in your FM paper. Just by simply making some calculation, dropping down, the correct answer, you gain full 2 marks. And if your answer is wrong, you either get 0 or you get full 2 marks. So please make sure that you're getting these full 2 marks. That is 2 into 15, 30 marks, very easy to score in your FM paper. Section B questions is going to comprise of 3 10-marker questions each, which is going to be having 3 case studies, each being split into 3 scenarios, having questions of 2 markers each being asked. So it's going to basically have 3 scenarios, each having 2 questions of 5 marks each. So that is why we say 3 into 10, that is 30 marks being allocated to Section B questions. Each question of this 10 marks is going to comprise of 5 smaller questions based on the same scenario which is given to you, right? And then Section C, the most important one. Remember, the question is either going to be coming from your Part D or your Part C of the syllabus. That's why I put it up at right at the beginning of your thing itself, that because this is where the constructive responses questions are going to be asked. Here, extremely important is to make sure that you're putting all the calculations on the Excel itself. Extremely important that you're giving away the questions in the correct format that is required. So the nice layouts, nice calculations, everything laid out. Then also very important is to be able to talk about these numbers. Don't just stop at solving questions. You have to make sure that you are going ahead and giving away your responses as well. So that is something which is again extremely important, right? Everybody okay with it? Everybody okay? Any doubts? Everybody understands the structure of the exam? We need to work as a finance manager while solving the case. Yes, absolutely. Put yourself in the shoes of a financial manager. That's what you are now. That is why you've been given the task to perform these calculations, talk about these numbers, give your recommendations, because you're now hired as a finance manager in XYZ Limited from today. Right, Hemant? Great. Okay, so this is what the structure looks like. Syllabus. Now, Section A, Section B questions, I said, are going to be definitely coming in from the entire syllabus. So 100% syllabus coverage is what is definitely required. Section A questions might be having certain MCQ questions as well. And what is the approach that we follow to be able to solve these MCQs? Very important is to identify and to read through the question very, very clearly, right? So that is a stem which talks about the question itself. Thereafter, we talk about a key, which is giving the correct answer per se. So that is out of the 4 options given to you, only 1 is the key. Rest remaining 3 incorrect options are distractors. So what we have to do is to make sure that we are being able to eliminate these distractors, which are very tempting because these are all plausible answers. They look like the correct answer to you, but remember, they are only incorrect options and have been deliberately planted here in the question to confuse you, to be able to lure you to mark these as, you know, one of the answers. So very important is to develop the skill to be able to identify the correct answer that is the key towards your answer, right? Everybody okay with it? Section C, like I said, section syllabus area C, syllabus area D, syllabus area E is definitely going to have certain Section C questions being put on it. So working capital management, investment appraisal, business finance, these are extremely important areas which you have to be looking at while you are solving your, while we are actually studying towards our FM paper as well. So very important to give due respect to these Section C questions that we have. So syllabus area C, syllabus area D, and syllabus area E is extremely important. Candidates are provided with the formula sheet and tables of discount as well as annuity factors. So now what is this we are talking about? Remember, in your FM paper, there will be certain preempted formulas that you need not learn. These formulas will also be provided to you. Which formulas will be provided to you and which ones you have to learn, I will be guiding you through when we actually study towards this subject, that okay, this is the calculus, this is the formula that we already know, this is the formula that we have to learn over and above. Candidates should bring a scientific calculator to the examination. Like I said, that scientific calculators are allowed in your FM paper. So please just make your life easy by using calculators and not, losing out on marks because of silly calculation errors. Right? Everybody okay with it? Anything you want me to repeat? Anything you want me to explain again? Please feel free to ask. So far, so good. All clear, says Nandu. What about others? So far, so good. Anything that you want me to change in the way I'm explaining things? Anything you want me to, any suggestions that you want me to improvise upon? Kindly show the calculators in the next class. Yes, absolutely. I will be showing the calculator to you. All clear, all good, pretty good, wonderful. Great. So let's proceed. Great. Thank you, everyone. So let's proceed. Time, like we've already mentioned, is only 1.8 minutes per mark. So section A, every question, 2 marks. 2 into 1.8, 3.6 minutes per mark. Drop dead, move on to the next question. Total section A is how many marks? Total section A is got your, it's got 15 questions under it. So do not allocate anything beyond your 54 minutes towards it. Yes. Section, your section A total is that. The 3 OT questions in section B again is 20 marker question, 20 marks in all. So you've got 20 into 1.8, that is 36 minutes to complete your section B questions as well. Thereafter, what we are doing, we are going to the 20 marker questions in section 30, in section C. Each question is 20 marks. So each question is going to take 20 into 1.8, that is your 36 minutes again are going to be gone here. So very important is to understand that how this time allocation has to be respected by each one of you, because if you do not respect this time allocation, you will just have no idea of where the time has gone. And there I have seen students who've struggled to even start attempting section C questions. Why? Because they wasted so much of time on section A and section B, which was definitely not required. The first marks are the easiest to gain in each longer type question. So it is always better to start the next question rather than overrunning on the time, like I've already mentioned. So it's rather than struggling with the question and overrunning on time, drop dead the question, move on to the next question and gain the easy marks of the next question. Ultimately, what do you need? You need to all pass your paper, right? So you need to have 50 minimum marks out of the 100 marks which are given to you. Nobody is asking you to get 100 out of 100, right? So why are you struggling with a question that is probably not making any sense to you? And you're losing out on time as well. Drop that down. Come back to it if you have time at the end of the exam. Try and solve it at that time if you have time. But at least solve the questions that you know. Do not be, and do not end up in a situation wherein you wasted time trying to do something that you didn't know and that left you with no time to do what you actually knew. That would be silly, right? So we are not going to do anything silly in our F9 paper. What we're going to do is study and pass, follow the right examination technique and just pass your paper, right? Okay. How to pass F9? We all want to know that, right? That is like That is why you and I are here. So this is exactly what we require. This is like going to be your mantra now. Will you be conducting tests also? Are we going to practice papers before exams? Yes, the answer is yes for both, Vaishnavi. So we will be doing a lot of question practice in the class itself. I will be giving you some questions as tests to be done at home by you. And I will also be doing practice questions like mock exams before the exam. So once our entire syllabus gets finished, we'll then be migrating towards the mock exams, solving questions not only on the practice platform, but also looking at a live, full-fledged question as to what does it actually look like, right? Are there any mock tests happening and expected number of mock tests? So Hemant, yes, mock tests are going to happen. I'll be assigning you certain mock exams at the end of the syllabus once we are actually done with the entire syllabus. And one mock exam I'm going to cover in the class. One mock exam I'm going to give you as homework to submit to me to be able to pass your paper. So that is the bare minimum. After that, sky is the limit. We can do as much as time will allow us. The subject FM more of a practical subject or a theory one? Nikhil, FM is mix of both practical as well as theory. Definitely, it's got certain amount of number crunching, but it is not only just number crunching. There would be questions which are asked to you, which are out and out theory questions as well. So without even just talking about any numbers, you are going to be asked straight out theory questions as well. Can we go through the normal calculator or do we have to use the scientific one? I recommend that you carry a scientific calculator because there will be certain calculations that you will be required to perform in your F9 paper, which will be more easily done on a scientific calculator. Right, Akash? Don't worry, buy it. You've got 2 months. We'll be using it together. So you'll know what it actually requires. Great. So now very important what to do to be able to pass it. Understand theory. Yes, very important. Understand the theoretical concepts. Be able to apply the formulas, not just, yes, certain formulas will be given to you, but application is something that you have to learn, right? You should be able to apply this particular formula. What does CO or CH and, D stands for in a formula is something that you should be able to know, interpret as well as apply. You should be able to interpret the requirements of the question. You should be able to practice exam questions in a timed environment. So this literally in the last, I think, 1 hour class we've had so far, and I've repeated it so many times that interpret requirements, understand question, understand, the requirements, answer it in terms of not just number crunching, but also interpreting about these numbers and time management. Very, very important. So this is something which like goes without saying now. Right. Today being the first class, I just wanted to put this down on a slide so that I run it through each one of you categorically, making things clear from day one itself. So all the questions you have to practice from today are going to be without pen and paper. It's a computer-based exam that you are giving. So I do not want anybody to be making use of pen and paper. Even though you're not sitting in a face-to-face class with me, remember, if you are still sitting at home taking this class and trying to fool me by solving the questions on pen and paper, I'm telling you today that you're not fooling me, but you're fooling yourself, because you're the one who will not be then familiar or confident or, experienced enough to be solving questions on the computer on the D-day of the exam. So I can only advise you. I can only guide you. But what is required from your end is to acknowledge my advice, is to follow my advice, right? So please, no pen and papers in the class, only making use of Excel and your Microsoft Word to be able to interpret data. There is going to be absolutely extremely important that you understand and give due respect to workings. Section A, Section B questions, which only require answers to be put in for 2 marks. You do not have to, you know, make fancy or neat workings for it. There is absolutely no need for it. What you have to do is to just start putting in your answers in the scratch pad itself, and then just, you know, and just scribble down the correct answer. That's all that is really required. But in your section C questions, what is extremely important is to make clear workings, is to put down extremely well laid out workings as well. So yes, you need to be able to understand the difference between workings that are put in the scratch pad or the rough paper, as we call it, which absolutely doesn't need to be beautified because nobody's going to be looking at it. But what workings we put down in the Excel, in the answer, that absolutely has to be neat, crisp, well understood, well labeled, so that the examiner knows that where this particular figure of 20,000 is coming from, right? Do not let the examiner guess that how you've come down to this figure of 20,000. Make good workings. Cover all topics, no selective study. I mean, I've already told you that 100% of the syllabus is extremely important, be it in section A, be it in section B, or in section C questions. But yes, definitely something which is extremely important. One idea, one mark is the general rule of thumb towards your ACCA paper, that, okay, one idea you've given, you'll probably be granted like 1 mark for it. Excuse me. Very important to understand that quality matters over quantity. So be very selective in what you are choosing for, and quality is something which is going to be extremely, extremely important, and more important over quantity. Rule of elimination simply states that when we are choosing your MCQ questions, just start by, you know, removing the distractor so that you narrow down and pull up the stem, which is like the correct answer, the key, which is like the correct answer, right? Answer all MCQs. Like I told you, worst to worst, you have no idea about what the question is asking about. Don't just leave it unattempted. There is no negative marking, right? So even if you're like completely clueless about it, just at least mark one option and then move ahead. Because why, what will happen? At least you have 25% probability of hitting the correct answer. Own figure rule. Okay, anybody understands what an own figure rule actually stands for? Any idea? What do we understand by the term own figure rule? Any idea in the class? Okay, looks like nobody has an idea. Okay, so own figure rule, simply step marking. That's right. That's right. So basically what happens is that own figure means, supposingly out of a 10 marker questions, you've made some wrong calculation in the second step itself. Based on this wrong calculations, you've then followed the correct, you know, the correct layout or the correct technique in the remaining question. So you will only be negatively, you'll only be marked incorrect in that one mark calculation that you've done wrong, if on the basis of that incorrect calculations, you followed the correct steps in the entire question that follows, you will not be marked incorrectly again for it. So it just simply means that what is happening is that the entire marks are not for the final answer only. So even if you've done one portion of the question incorrectly, you will only be marked incorrectly for it once only, right? Great. Also very important is to understand that the subjective answers in the question is going to use headings, as well as new paragraphs are going to be there. So, you know, we are trying to make our answers more legible. We are trying to make our answers look more beautiful. So what do we have to do for that? We have to make use of headings to put down the header in a bold and then very briefly explain it in the form of a small paragraph that follows the heading. After that, what do? We go on to the next one, make a heading again, and again explain the heading in the next part of the question. So very important is for everyone to follow these basic tips. Why I'm explaining them to you today itself, Why I'm showing them to you right now is that from day one itself, each one of us is clear as to what do we have to do to be able to pass this FM paper, right? Any queries anybody has? Anything you want to ask? Any questions? Any questions? Any queries? What about others? I've only got a few responses. Anything anybody wants to ask? Okay, great. Great, great. Thank you. Okay, technical articles, very important for everyone to understand that apart from the workbook, apart from the practice and revision kit, we also have to go through these recommended technical articles, which are available on ACCA's website free of any cost. So very important is to, as a very basic thing, you at least go through the articles which I've mentioned on the slider. Can we use Excel during the program? So Sahil, in the exam, there will be a platform which is very similar to that of an Excel. I will take you through the practice platform. I will show you how the exam and you know what the platform looks like. The functionality is very similar to that of an Excel, but it is not the licensed product of Microsoft Excel. So that is why for our practice, we'll be making use of the practice platform and Microsoft Excel. Right, Sahil? Okay, so these are the recommended technical articles, which as a bare minimum, you all have to read towards your SBL, towards your FM paper before sitting for the exam. Obviously, as of now, we've literally just starting off the session, so you don't have an idea of what these terms are like, but this is something that you have to do before we actually sit for the exam itself. Okay, so that was just a very basic introduction that I wanted to give regarding the paper financial management. Now, during this class or at any time whatsoever, apart from the WhatsApp groups, I'm also available for any query resolution over an email, which is given on your screen. So my email ID is shilpiacca@gmail.com. Obviously, WhatsApp, email, whatsoever, you know, is more convenient to you, you can always reach out to me. I'll try and revert back at the earliest possible. But yes, very important is for all of you to be able to come up to me and ask questions. There you are. Right, Dipansh? Right? Shall I scroll through? Okay, so now that we understand the basic, the paper, we now have like absorbed a little bit of what we are actually heading into. I'm just going to give a very quick 15 minutes break for everyone to absorb this information. And then we're going to start off with chapter one from your FM paper, right? So let's break for 15 minutes and then I shall start with chapter one on your financial management paper. So see you all in 15 minutes from now. Okay, so do we have everyone back from the break? Okay, so some discussions happening around books. It is always advisable to please purchase the latest books. And like we discussed, so these notes which I'm showing to you, I will be sharing that on email as well as available on the LMS. And apart from that, you just need to purchase the practice and revision kit of BPB, which is like a must purchase and a must do. Apart from that, workbook is something which you can, you know, decide whether you want to purchase or not. But I would advise that you go ahead and purchase that too, because that will just give you like a hands-on book available for you to be able to practice questions later on as well. All these questions from the workbook, we will be anyways discussing in the class itself. Let me just very quickly show you the books as well. Okay, let me just open up the books. Where are my books? Not these. Okay, so this is the book. This is my valid towards your June 21 exam. This is the BPP workbook, which we will be referring to. Apart from this, we'll be doing question practice from the revision kit as well. So this is what the revision kit looks like. Apart from the questions that we'll be doing in the class, each and every question from this practice and revision kit has to be done by you for every topic whatsoever. At the end of these books, we do have some mock exams. So we'll be solving a few in the class. And then the remaining, you obviously have to do as part of your practice. Okay, so these are the mock exams at the end of it. Just wanted to show you what it looks like, what a full-fledged question looks like. This is just on the computer. Okay, so let's very quickly have run through a mock exam just to understand what it looks like. We will be solving it at the end of our syllabus as well. Should we also practice Kaplan revision kit or only BPP will be sufficient? Well, if you do each and every question from the BPP practice and revision kit along with mock exams and the questions that we are doing in the class, following either BPP or Kaplan one is sufficient. I would request that you follow the BPP workbook because I personally feel the quality is better. Will you tell us how to practice questions on Excel? Sakshi, we will be doing questions on Excel. So I will not be just only telling you, but I will be making you solve questions on Excel as well. Right, Sakshi? Can you please share the PPT for a few days as we've not ordered the books yet? Which PPT? This notes PPT, which I'm showing in the class, will be shared with you. The books you will have to order and the team will get back to you very soon. Okay, Hemant? Class PPT, yes, that you will receive. Okay, so before we actually start off with the first, the first chapter, let me just very quickly show you what a full-fledged exam actually looks like. So this is a mock exam which includes actual questions which were asked in the September and December 2019 Section C exam questions. So very much, incorporating the standard of the actual exam itself. This is what the exam is going to look like. Obviously, it will be on the computer. So you'll have Section A questions. Obviously, all compulsory 15 marks questions. Most of them would be MCQ based or probably you need to type in the answer. This is what it looks like. Thereafter, this is Section B. Again, 15 questions are going to be there. They are going to be each scenario. Section B, there is one small scenario followed by 5 questions of 2 marks each on each one of these scenarios. So there you are. Right? So what you have to do is just type in the correct answer here. No marks for workings are going to be here in Section A and Section B. So no need to beautify your workings. But Section C, definitely workings have to be there, workings have to be beautified. Again, the second question of Section B. So there's one, this scenario, followed by 5 questions based on the same scenario, right? One more, and then the same format is there. Section C, this is what the question looks like. So there is going to be a case study given to you. You'll be required to perform all of these calculations. You'll have to do some, recommendations. And look at this question here. So you are asked to discuss the key factors in determining working capital funding strategies. Purely theory question. So yes, definitely you need to give due respect to your theory questions as well, right? I'm just only showing it to you to familiarize you with, you know, what sort of questions are going to be asked so that you know what is it that you need to learn. So calculate, calculate, recommend, discuss, discuss. So again, all of these three questions are your theory questions. So in the first two parts, you only just have to like make certain calculations. But in all of these following, you have to be able to talk about your theoretical concepts as well. So yes, that is what the exam is going to look like. Everybody okay with it? Everybody okay with it? Shall I show you the CBE practice platform as well? So everybody has to log on to your MyACC account. From there, there is a link. I'll just show it to you. Of the ACCA practice platform. And that is your tool which you have to utilize extensively throughout your FM paper, because that is a platform which replicates or simulates the real life exam. Let me just very quickly show you all the tools where they are available so that from day one itself, you know what is it that you have to look into. So www.accaglobal.com is where we log on. Yeah, sorry, I just need to type something to everyone. It's just only gone to Sakshi practice platform. There you are. This is what I'm just showing you on the screens now. Apart from that, I'm also showing you the ACCA study support resources, which are available from ACCA itself, extremely useful tools, which you have to look at. So that will also incorporate your technical articles, which I just showed to you. So this is the website. I hope everybody is familiar with it. ACCAglobal.com. You go under the student section, go under study support resources. Select your qualification, ACCA. Select your paper, FM. You're looking for B. So this literally has a lot of good, information which is available to you from ACCA's side. So we have our practice questions here. So this is the practice platform. You can log on to it from here, or you can directly go on to your MyACCA account and just view it. These are some of the resources, the specimen exams, the practice exams, which are available. This is what the blank workspace looks like. I will just quickly, very quickly show you the practice platform itself. So what do you need to do? Just use your MyACC account to log on to the practice platform. So just sign in and that's about it, right? Is everybody okay with it? That how do we literally use our platform? How do you access to this platform? Is everybody okay with it? Great. So now what I'm going to show you is what it actually looks like. What are the technical articles? So technical articles are articles given by the examiner on the particular subject. So here are the technical articles. See technical articles here. You read the subject, right? Technical articles, again available on the website itself. So these are your technical articles. These are the topics. You must go through these. These are additional, apart from your books, these are additional resources, additional, you can say, articles written by the examiner on your particular topic. And because they are written by the examiner, definitely, what do we need to give to them? We need to give them some due respect by you don't have to learn them. You don't have to like memorize them, but just having a good read of these articles will actually give you a heads up as to what is it that is there. How many lectures will we have? Approximately, there will be 10 to 15 lectures, depending upon what sort of time, you know, is involved in solving particular questions. Because sometimes if I'm required to repeat a particular question again and again, then obviously it takes a little more time. But approximately, it will be a study of, say, about some 40 to 45 hours, so which we can cover in some, you know, 10 or 15 odd days. Right, Nikhil? These are all the technical articles available. These are over and above your books, but something that you must actually look at. Now, let me very quickly just show you the practice platform as well. Let me log on to it. So similarly, you can log on to it from your own account, which I've just shown you that how do you log on to it. Okay. So we select financial management, official resources. We've got some past exams. We've got specimen questions on it. So I'm just going to very quickly show you what it looks like. So I'm just assigning the paper. So this is exactly what your exam is going to look like. The look and feel of it is going to look like. Just bear with me for 1 second. Okay, so everybody able to see the screen? So this is what your exam is going to look like. I'm just only, these practice exams on ACCA website paid? No, Akash, these are all free resources available to you. So please utilize these resources. And you know, this literally is like, apart from the classes, apart from, you know, your technical clarity, you need to be able to avail these resources. You need to be able to utilize these resources so that you're actually exam ready in the broader sense of the word. Right? So why before even actually, you know, showing you the topics and taking you through session one, which is like the actual topic, I wanted to just show you what the exam is going to look like. So that's why I've logged on to the CBE practice platform so that you know how we're going to be looking at, you know, what question practice is required, how question practice is required as well. Okay, so this is like very basic introduction. I'm not going to go through all of it because I'll be keeping a separate session purely focusing on the CBE practice platform, but I'm just showing you what the exam is going to look like. There are going to be certain set of instructions given here. Okay, because I haven't scrolled the entire set of information, it doesn't allow me to scroll through it. So there is this formulae sheet which is given to you. This is something that we can log on to. You have this highlight functionality. You have the strike through functionality. You have the scratch pad functionality to use on. There is an inbuilt calculator as well. I'll just very quickly show you through these platform. You can type in, you can navigate. You can navigate question on question. You review the exam to make sure that you've gone through all the requirements and then you end your exam. This is all part of the instructions. Okay, so again, section A, section B, section C, we know all of that. We're just going through and actually entering into the exam. Are you ready, ready to begin your exam? Are you ready? Yes, we are ready. Okay, so this is what the exam is going to look like. Section A is going to have 15 questions of 2 markers each. Thank you. We know that. Okay, so let's very quickly have a look at the question itself. So this is how the question is going to be like. You've been given this small box to do your calculation, to do basically type in your answers. Apart from this, what is required is to have a look at the help or the formula sheet, So there is this scratch pad functionality wherein I can make my calculations. This scratch pad will not be viewed by the examiner. This is only for your rough workings. At the centers, you're also allowed a physical rough paper as well. That is again something that you can log on to. Do your calculations, type in the correct answer. I'm just hypothetically marking in something here. What is the minimum share price to the nearest whole numbers is what I have to enter. So I am just typing it down. Okay, 45, whatever. And then this is the calculator which is given to you in the exam platform itself. You can choose a standard calculator, or you could go on to the scientific mode of it as well. Again, this is something which is available to you within the practice platform. I somehow do not feel comfortable. If you are, you are more than welcome to use it. I personally feel more comfortable using a physical calculator. Then there is functionality of a highlight. I can highlight my question. I can strike through something that, you know, I find is actually not relevant and I need not waste my time reading it again. I can just strike through it. I can put down my answers in making use of the symbols that are given. So my answer can choose the correct currency and I can just insert it if required. Obviously this question doesn't require to, so that's why it's giving me an error. And that's about it really. And this is how it looks like. This is the formula sheet which will be given to you. So these formulas you need not learn in your FM paper. These formulas are again given in your books as well. So this formula sheet will be given to you. One important thing to note here is that this formula sheet gives you the formula, but what does COD or CH stand for is not given here. So even if the formula is given, you need to understand, you need to be able to, you know, evaluate what a particular field actually stands for. Right. So this is the formulas which you would be given in your F9 paper. This list is given to you in your books as well as on the platform itself. Then there would be certain tables which we will be requiring to make use of while solving our questions. So present value tables as well as annuity tables will be given to you like this. How do you interpret them? How do you read them? This is something which I will be teaching you when we actually come to the relevant topic. Right. Any questions? Let me just take you through section C questions, because this is section A wherein I just need to like put in, type in and move forward. Thereafter, I'm just taking you through the platform and not the actual questions, because this is obviously way too early for it. Okay, so this is what the questions look like. It's going to show you section B and section C questions as well. So because I haven't viewed the entire screen, the system prompts me to actually go through the entire screen. Very well. Okay, so now we are on section B. It's going to have three objective test questions. Each question is going to have 2 marks questions. So this is the scenario. This scenario relates to this question. This scenario relates to this question. This scenario relates to the next set of questions. So this scenario on the left-hand side is the same, which links to the next 5 set of questions, right? All I really need to do is solve through these 2 markers each and that's it. So this, because 5 questions have ended, this is the next question now coming up. This is what it looks like. Just want to show you the constructed response type of section C so that you know what sort of platform will be available to you to solve your questions. That will just basically rest all your queries. That's why I'm just navigating through the question with you, the actual exam, what it is going to look like. This is how it looks. Okay. Wonderful. Can we move on to section C? So this is your section C. It's going to have 2 constructive response questions. I'm going to try and solve a little bit of background sound issue which is coming. So I'll just buy some speakers, some headphones for myself, for so that the sound quality can also be improvised a little bit. Right, so this is what the question looks like. And you've been given this Excel kind of a worksheet to put down your answers in. This is your question, right? And based upon this question here, you need to be able to evaluate whether Knee Suit Company should accept the early settlement discount offered by its supplier. So what I will be requiring to do is do some calculations. So this is exactly what the spreadsheet looks like. Very much similar to an Excel, but not Microsoft Excel, right? Is everybody okay with it now? And for the written part also, let me just show you what it looks like. That's why I've taken you here. Okay, so this is what it looks like. Again, you're required to do some calculations. So they've given you an Excel-like platform. Okay, buddy, let me just go through the entire question. Okay. See, now the question says, critically discuss how Knee Suit Company could improve the management of its trading receivables. What you're required to do here is do certain discussions. So you obviously need like a paper, you need like a Microsoft Word kind of a platform to type in your answers, right? So Knee Suit Company can log on to the following parameters. I'm just, without even reading anything, I'm just typing down that this is how a platform will be given to you to type in your answers like a Microsoft Word platform, right? Is that okay with everyone? Is everyone now confident of what the exam is going to look like and what platforms will be available to you to type in your answers? What I have not viewed in this question, the system keeps prompting me to do something more. Again, I am required to make certain calculations and pop comes out the Excel kind of platform. So very well. Let's go through this because obviously we're not solving it for now. I'm just familiarizing you with the platform. This is what it is going to look like. Okay, what is it? So this is this review screen which is going to come up to you before you actually end your exam. So I've obviously not done the question. So it is telling me that, hey, all these questions are incomplete, but I just still want to just end my exam. One very important functionality is that it actually can show me if I've literally flagged a particular question. So supposedly I just want to go back to this section, this question. What I can do is I can also flag it for review and then go back. So when I actually come down to the navigator, it shows that I have done what? I have flagged this question. So I can come back to this question later on because I flagged it for review. So before ending my exam also, it is prompting that I have literally flagged up something which I haven't gone back to as yet. Right? Let me just... Okay, something seems to have gone wrong here, but this is literally what the exam is going to look like. This sheet doesn't allow us to use all shortcuts like in Excel, but makes the speed a bit slow. Yes, like I said, Akash, it is something which is similar to your Excel, but obviously because it is not your Microsoft Excel, it doesn't have all the functionality which is going to be there in a Microsoft Excel. Do we need to enhance our vocabulary as the exam is from UK? Vaishnavi, to be honest, basic English knowledge is what is required. That's precisely why I'm only talking in English in the class itself, so that you all understand the basic, the jargons or the vocabulary or the wordings that is required to be utilized. And that's it apart from it. If there's anybody who personally feels that, you require some sort of additional help on your English, there is also a BPP free English course, which is available on your MyACC account. Let me just very quickly show that to you as well while we're talking about it. Let me just go back. So this is all the support that you require on your FM paper. So there is one. Yeah, there it is. Maths and English language support, which is very, very basic English and maths level, BPP knowledge bank, which is available. Again, this is a free course. Just in case you feel that, you probably could use a little bit of help in English and maths, you can definitely log on to this and just, very quickly undertake this course as well. It is a completely free course available from BPP. Right, Vaishnavi? Also, do we need to stick to technical terms? Well, yes, Vaishnavi, it's a professional level exam that you are doing. So we should be able to, use all our platforms, we should be able to utilize the correct jargons which are required. Sure, Akash, I'll share my LinkedIn ID on the WhatsApp group itself. I don't remember it offhand here. So I'll share it on WhatsApp group. Right? Great. Okay, so this is what it is. So now that we are diving into our financial management paper, let's very quickly review the pass rates. So September 19, 50% of the students who appeared for this FM paper globally passed the paper. 43% in December 19, 44% in March, 52% in September, and 45% in December. Literally, this is something which is definitely not encouraging. So what we have to aim from today itself is to be amongst the percent of people who are passing the exam. And this is like global pass rate. So make sure that you are following what I'm telling you to follow in the class, and I will ensure that you pass your paper. But for that, I require sincerity. I require sincere efforts from all of you as well. Right? Any doubts anybody has? Can we start off with the first session then? Oops, what have I done? Any queries? Anybody would like to ask anything? Are we good to start off with the first chapter? So we're starting off with syllabus area A section, this is the session which talks about very broadly the financial management function per se. So let's very quickly have a look at this. Let me just go on a full screen mode. Everybody able to see the screen? Great. Right, so your first topic talks very broadly about the subject. It obviously talks about the financial management function. So now you've been assigned from today, each one of you have been assigned as a finance manager in XYZ Limited. And obviously, because you're now the finance manager, you now need to first understand that what is your KRA, right? You need to understand what financial management function is all about. Why is it that it is important? What is your importance in the organization? Why are we studying this subject? What skills it is going to groom you with? What sort of, positions do you land up in organizations? And what sort of job opportunities, what sort of job roles would you be undertaking as part of a financial, as being a financial manager? So all of this is what we're going to study in this chapter today. Let's first understand the very basic definition of the financial management. Like we've already discussed it in the class, so I've taken your thoughts on it already. Now we're just going to have a look at the technical definition of the financial management function, which includes Bear with me for 1 second. I'll just join you back. Okay, so let's start. Very broadly, we all know that as financial managers, you're now required to take care of where the money is going to come from, what you're going to do with this money, and once your money has earned more money, what do you do with the revenue that you've earned? Are you going to distribute it as dividends? Are you going to reinvest it in good projects? So all of that really is going to be the financial management function. So the management of activities associated with the efficient acquisition. So where you are actually, you know, getting the funds from. So acquisition as well as what you are doing with these funds. So acquisition as well as use of both short as well as long-term financial resources. So what are we doing with the money? Everything related to your financial management function. Where the money is coming from, where you're utilizing it, where is it actually ending in? That is your financial management function. The management of the finances of an organization in order to achieve the financial objectives of the organization is your financial management function, is what the definition of the term financial management is, right? Everybody understands this term. Everybody understands that what is the subject that we are studying? Any queries in this definition? Anything anybody wants to ask in this definition? Okay, just please feel free to drop in a message in the chat box or unmute yourself to ask any queries whatsoever you have from now, because literally, you know, we're literally now starting with the technical concepts of our FM paper, right? Okay. Now, very important, as a finance manager, the first thing you should be good at is planning. So because you need to be able to plan so that you know what is going to be expected from you and how you're going to be able to deliver it. So like we are studying for our FM paper, the first thing that we did was in the session that we've had so far, we reviewed our plan, right? So similarly, as a finance manager, very important is for you to be able to plan that what is it that I will be required to do so that you have the time to be able to plan for it as well. So the finance manager will need to plan to ensure that enough funding is available at the right time to meet the needs of the organization towards short-term sources of finance, towards short-term requirements, which is going to be your working capital requirement, towards your medium-term requirement, which is going to cover your non-current assets, as well as your long-term capital needs that is going to cover your long-term debt. So short-term, medium-term, long-term, all types of requirements of funds, you should be able to preemptively test like a finance manager to be able to plan what you aim to deliver, right? So very important is to be able to plan it effectively, right? So very important is financial planning. Now, very important, and this is something that we've already discussed, that what sort of decisions will you be making as a finance manager? Obviously, you will be deciding upon where are you going to raise the funds from. So important terminology to learn here is your, that as a finance manager, you make certain financing decisions. Where is the fund going to come from? What sort of funds are you going to raise? Are you going to raise debt? Are you going to raise equity? Are you going to go the bank loan route? Where is the fund and what type of fund is going to be raised? So financing decisions, extremely important. Then once you've arranged for the funds, what are you going to do with it? We're obviously not going to just sit on it, right? We're going to make certain investment decisions that what do I do with these funds? I'm obviously going to invest it somewhere to be able to earn a good return for myself. So on which proposed investment should the funds be spent? Where am I going to invest my funds on? Very important is to understand the dividend policy. So once my money I've invested in somewhere in Project X has given me, say, 100 million pounds in return. What do I do with this 100 million pounds? I obviously need to make decisions regarding how much of this money am I going to require to, you know, pay back my dues? How much of this money can I invest in more lucrative projects? And how much of this money should I actually give back to the real owners of the company, who are the shareholders of the organization? So how much dividend do I need to pay off to the shareholders? So very important decisions that we are making is financing decision, investment decision, dividend policy decision, right? So very broadly, do you all understand the three types of decisions which you as a finance manager of XYZ company will now be making? Everybody okay with it? Everybody okay? Okay, so let's move and understand each types of these decisions. So when we talk about investment decision, what sort of investment decisions are we making? When we talk about financing decisions, what sort of financing decisions are we making? When we talk about dividend decisions, what sort of decisions are we talking? And this literally is like your entire syllabus broken down into three, you know, important job roles that you will be performing. So the entire syllabus that I just shown you is revolving around these three important decisions only, right? Okay, so investment decisions. Some investment decisions are internal to the business. Any idea? Give me an example of what sort of investment decisions are internal to the organization. So something that the management will probably sit down together and decide that, okay, this is what we need to do. The investment decision, which is internal to the business. Give me some ideas. Investment in research and development. That's right, Jatin. So the management is going to discuss that, okay, in order to improvise our product, we need to spend, say, 10 million pounds purely on the R&D division of the organization. So yes, R&D, very important. Asset purchase, marketing. Yes, very good answers, Jatin and Surbhi, that these are certain investment decisions which are internal to the organization. So, you know, where are we actually investing the money in? Staff welfare. Yes, absolutely. You could be, you could be talking about this as well. Garima, do we need to write down or you will be providing the PPT? No need to write down anything, Garima. Just understand the concepts. These notes which I've prepared for you guys, I will be sharing that with you. Don't worry. So just only understand the concepts. And when I require you to solve questions, that is when you have to, you know, start actually solving questions. No worries at all, Garima. Thank you. Okay. So yes, these are certain internal decisions to the organization. Decisions involving external parties. So, okay, what sort of investment decisions can we be making? But these decisions are going to involve, you know, people who are beyond your organization, people who are external parties. So decisions obviously will be taken within the organization, but it involves people, it involves parties who are external to the organization. So tell me, what sort of decisions do you think would be there that involves external parties? So today, XYZ Limited thinks and decides to probably buy out company ABC. So yes, definitely. That's right, Kush, that a merger or an acquisition decision is an external party involvement. CSR, yes. So what sort of CSR initiatives do we want to take with external parties and, you know, provide benefits to the people in the long run? It could be including outsourcing. Sorry, I think I missed out on a few inputs here. Let me just come up. So why am I on the top of the conversation chart? Investment, purchasing asset, yes. This was also done. It could include outsourcing the work that we have, taking a call on that. So yes, are we literally, you know, outsource our internal operations to an external party, a specialist organization, which is the outsourcing company? Yes, so that that is included in one of your decisions regarding external parties as well. Consolidation, investments in startups, which has, what is it? Which has great future potential. Yes, absolutely. So mergers and acquisitions, outsourcing. Yes, Vaishnavi. So yes, all of these decisions involve external parties to the organization. Disinvestment decisions, whether to sell off the unprofitable segments of the business or whether to sell surplus or old plant and machinery, the sale of subsidiaries. So disinvestment, where are we withdrawing our investments? So why do we do that? Unprofitable, licensing issues probably, not worth the effort. I don't want to disinvest from this particular subsidiaries. All of these involve disinvestment decisions. Sick units, discontinued operations. Good points, Jatin and Aryan, that yes, these are all decisions revolving around disinvestment. So it could be because the unit is not profitable. So, you know, I'm going to sell off my sick units. This particular operations, I cannot continue because I don't have the license for it anymore. Disinvestment decision, whether to sell a surplus or an old plant and machinery, again, a disinvestment decision. So yes, all of these decisions you will be making now as a finance manager in your XYZ Limited. Question mark segment. So yes, you know, you talk about it. You know, what do I do with these products? What do I do with these segments? Do I just withdraw my investment or should I pump in probably more resources to be able to pull it off? Yes. So these are all decisions regarding investment, right? Is everybody okay with the investment decisions that you are requiring to make as a finance manager? Everybody okay with it? Read through it funds quickly. Let me know if you have any queries pertaining to it. Where's my chat box? Okay, wonderful. Any queries? Everybody understands that as a finance manager now in XYZ Limited, you have to make these investment decisions. PNM is plant and machinery. Right? Okay, wonderful. So let's proceed. Now, very well, we all understand that, you know, there is an arm of accounting which talks about financial accounts. And there is an arm of accounting which talks predominantly about management accounts. Right? We've all heard the terms. Any idea what is management accounting and how is it different from financial accounting? Any inputs from the class? Tell me. Management accounting versus financial accounting. Users of both the accounts are different. Yes, so the target audience for which it is prepared is different. Management accounts are purely prepared for the insight of the management, whereas financial accounts are prepared for evaluating and showing the results to the owners of the company, who are the shareholders of the organization. So that's right. Management accounting is for the board of directors and financial accounting is part of management accounting. Yes, financial accounting, you can say, will be a part and parcel of your management accounting because management obviously needs to review the financial part of the accounting as well. Sorry, where am I? Just go on a full screen mode. It helps. Financial management accounting uses qualitative aspects as well. Good point, Jatin, because not only are we just looking at the numbers in management accounting, but we're also looking at the qualitative aspects as well. We're talking about figures like, you know, are your employees happy? What is the work-life balance that you're providing? What is the attrition rate of your organization? So you're talking about qualitative aspects as well. Financial accounting is required by law, whereas management accounting is discretionary. Yes, that's right. Financial accounting is something that you have to prepare as part of your accounting, as part of your, it's mandated, right? If you're running a company. Whereas management accounting is purely, you know, prepared at the discretion of the management to help them make informed decisions for the betterment of the organization. It helps management accounting in taking important decisions. That's right. Management accounting are custom made. Yes, because I can, you know, I can ask my employees to prepare the reports which I'm looking for. Whereas your financial accounts, there is a stipulated framework wherein you have to comply to and, you know, prepare the reports in that format. Management accounting helps to make internal decisions. Management accounting is for costing purpose and financial accounting is for financing purpose. That's right. Financial one can be both internal as well as external parties. So that's right. Good inputs from the class. So very quickly read through this table of bifurcation that I've prepared for you. Financial accounting just presents data, whereas financial management, their data helps in controlling and decision-making as well. Whereas management accounting, right? That's right. So there you are. Very quickly, just go through the set of, let me just put down in this in a smaller, yeah. So go through this, please. Go through this differentiation. Again, these are all the points that we've just discussed in the class. So most of you, I think, have covered whatever is given here. But in case you want me to explain anything to you, please feel free to ask. It's a reiteration of what the class itself has told me. So that's well done. Quickly read through this. Right? Any doubt? Anybody wants to ask anything? So financial accounts, obviously we're talking about the details of the performance of the organization over, you know, like we are preparing the balance sheet. It is prepared over the last 1 year. So balance sheet as of the 31st of March, 2021 is going to have all the details regarding your, you know, your operations from the 1st of April 2020 to the 31st of March 2021. So that is how, you know, it talks about from a particular period of time up till a particular period of time as well. However, under management accounting, there is no such, you know, predefined periods that is going to be there. Limited companies must by law prepare the financial accounts. So obviously, you know, they are warranted. You have to be able to prepare these accounts. There is no legal requirement to prepare your management accounts. That's right again. Format is determined by law and the accounting standards itself. That is true. Under management accounts, there is no strict rules as per the management's discretion. I can get, you know, whatsoever report I'm seeking out for. This is something which is like discretionary to the management. Concentrate on business as a whole, whereas the focus is on specific areas only. Mostly of a monetary nature, or it incorporates non-monetary measures as well. So something that we've already done. Historic picture of past operations. Okay, so this is what I think Vaishnavi wanted me to clarify. So when I'm preparing my financial accounts, what does it actually show? It shows the performance of the organization over the past. So it's historic over the past 12 months, right? So it is clearly a historic representation of what has already gone past. Whereas under management accounting, we not just can look at, you know, what has already gone past, but we can also predict the future as well. So we can be talking about what is the planning or what is the future planning tool that we have for ourselves. So that is something that we can definitely be looking at under management accounting. Right, Vaishnavi? Great. Let me very quickly show you something as well. See, the way I like to operate my classes is that I do not want anybody to just sit and listen to what I'm saying. Like, you know, I want everybody to be involved in the class. I want everybody to stay awake. So I will, you know, try and show you some good value adding videos as well. So that you understand these concepts much better. The only thing is that I do not want to, you know, show anything which is like boring. So I really like these animated videos. This is what I endeavor to show you just to clear the concept. I'm sharing the link with you. Just in case you're not able to hear the video, let me just see how I've logged in. Share sound. Okay, so you should all be able to hear the video as well. Just in case you're not able to hear it, I have already shared. Sorry, I have only sent it to Hemant. I have already shared the link on the group itself, on the this chat box itself. So you can actually log on to it from there as well. Let's very quickly have a look at a good video on it. Management accounts are not audited, Jatin. These are purely just prepared for the management to review. Right? Yes, this is only an internal report which gets prepared purely for the insight of the management. There is no requirement of getting these reports audited. No, not even internal audit is required because this is purely, you know, information which the management has sought for. If the management wants to get this information audited, then probably they can, you know, they can get it done. But this is something which is not warranted or this is something which is not required per se. Right? Okay. So now that we understand broadly what financial management is, we understand what we are talking about. Let's now have a look at the term strategy. So what do we understand by the term strategy? Any idea? What do you understand by the term strategy? So for the last 2-3 hours whatsoever we've had, you know, in our financial management paper, these classes so far, what have we been discussing in the first 2 hours? The strategy for our financial management paper, right? So that is precisely any target that we want to achieve in life, we must always prepare a strategy to be able to achieve that plan. So it is a course of action to achieve an objective. So as a financial management student right now, your objective is to be able to pass your paper. as a financial manager in an organization, your objective will be to achieve targets which have been given to you. Your objective will be to achieve XYZ goals which have been assigned to you. So obviously, how do you achieve it? You're not going to sleep over it and, you know, one day suddenly it will be achieved. No, right? Obviously, we require strategy to be able to review it. Strategy is a course of action to achieve an objective. Three main levels of strategy in an organization follow: corporate strategy, business strategy, as well as operational or functional strategy. So that is what the strategy of an organization broadly, these are the three levels wherein we will be preparing our strategy. So the management, the top management at the very top, they are the ones who will be preparing the corporate strategy of the organization. So that like gives an overall, you know, direction to the organization, because this is part of the corporate strategy. Up next, each individual business unit is going to have its own business level strategy. So that is, you know, how do we achieve this corporate strategy? How do we achieve this corporate goal which has been assigned to us by the top management? Break it down to different business units into particular markets, and how do you literally tackle this? At the operational or the functional level, we have scientific strategies for different departments of the business. So what are we looking at? What sort of strategies do we have for different departments of the business per se? So that's an operational or a functional strategy that you can be following right at the bottom level. But yes, definitely, you know, it's like a pyramid. At the bottom level, people who are actually doing the job at the ground level need to follow the business level strategy, which has been formulated for them at the mid-level, which obviously in turn is to be aligned to the overall vision, mission, objective of the organization, which is set at the top level at the corporate level. So strategy decided, goals decided at the corporate level, then further flow into the different levels within the organization, right? So that is what the strategy broadly talks about. Okay with everybody? Everybody understands the term strategy? Okay, great. Well, I've run out of water. I think it's a good time to break for lunch and then we shall continue. So let's quickly take a quick half an hour break for lunch and then we shall continue. So it's 2:30. I'll join you at 3 p.m. again, right? Okay, so let's very quickly all have lunch and resume at 3. Okay, so do we have everyone back on? I hope you've all had a good lunch. Okay, so as an organization, we need to start off with understanding that what is the organizational objective? What is it that we stand for? What is it that we are looking to achieve? So once you understand the objectives clearly, seriously, as a finance manager, you obviously will be able to deliver because you know what is your objective. So if your target, you know, if your objective is to reach out certain profit targets, your targets could be, your objectives could be to increase the market share. It could be, you know, in terms of the price share promotion. It could be in terms of any concerns, any, you know, sociological benefits that you want to provide, improvise upon the work-life balance of your employees. What sort of cash flows are coming into the organization? What sort of support or service are we providing to our, you know, to our customers? What is the quality of the firm's products? The, you know, whether your workforce is happy with the, what you are offering? What sort of work-life balance are you providing to them? As well as what sort of cordial industrial relations are we maintaining within the organization, within the industry in which we operate? So yes, these could be a list of, you know, few organizational objectives that would be allocated to you as a finance manager to be able to work upon, to be able to achieve from your, obviously through you, through your team, through the entire strategy which the organization is going to make for itself, right? Right. So now we all understand that as management, as financial manager of the organization, one of the primary objective that you have is to be able to achieve the shareholders' wealth maximization, right? So we need to understand that how are we going to ensure, or how do we calculate basically whether the shareholders' wealth has been maximized or not. So what these are few of the financial objectives and few of the methods in which we will be calculating whether this shareholders' wealth has increased or not. So we have methods like the statement of financial position, which is the balance sheet valuation, wherein all the assets are going to be valued as a going concern basis. What do you understand by the term going concern? What do you understand by the term going concern? Tell me. What do we understand by the term going concern? It simply means that the business is going to keep on operating in the foreseen future. Jatin says business will be carried on for an indefinite period. Business will run for the foreseeable future. That's right, Manish. That the business is not going to be liquidated in the next financial year or so, right? So it's a going concern. So we can as value all the assets on the basis that the business is going to operate in the foreseeable future, and then find out our position as in the balance sheet that we call it, right? So that obviously assesses or gives us a brief in terms of what does the business valuation look at. So you value all the assets on going concern basis. The parameter obviously here would be whether year on year the company is increasing in the retained profit. So what happens when that happens? Obviously, upon liquidation, whatsoever funds the organization has gets distributed to the ultimate owners of the organization, who are the shareholders. So that in turn increases the shareholders' wealth, right? So that is what the statement of financial positions valuation method talks about. Then we have a look at the breakup analysis, the breakup basis, wherein when business is threatened with liquidation, management is thinking of selling off individual assets to raise cash. So if not on the going concern basis and the business is being threatened upon liquidation, then what do? We will be selling off certain individual assets to be able to raise cash for the business. And whatsoever is remaining after doing this breakup, that predominantly tells what is the overall shareholders' wealth and whether it is maximizing or not, right? Everybody understands this? So the next wave in which we're going to do, and we're going to do question practice on this as well, is looking at the market value. Very simple, example I will ask you. Today, if I want to see that, how is Reliance Industries doing, what do I do? Tell me. If I just want to find out that how is Reliance Industries operating, what are the various ways in which you can be, trying to find this out? Okay, where is my chat box? Share price, market value and share price. So yes, very rightly identified. The financials, check the financial statements, market cap, profit for the period. Yes, so these are all financial parameters which are telling us about the financial health of an organization, going through the fundamentals, going through the balance sheet, going through on a breakup basis. And definitely we can be looking at the market value of the organization, which is going to be reflected by your dividends received as well as the market value of shares that we are offering. So total shareholder return, there is a formula for it, wherein we can basically calculate, making use of this formula to find out what is the total shareholder return. You should be familiar with this formula. You should know how to implement this formula, because yes, it can be asked as a two marker question. So the formula to learn here is the total shareholder return, which is equals to P1 minus P0 plus your D1 divided by P0. P0 stands for your share price at the beginning of the period. T1 stands for your share price at the end of the period, and D1 is the latest dividend which has been paid. So what we will do, we will very quickly jump on to our BPP workbook and look at the questions that we have available to be able to practice upon this. So let me just very quickly open up your BPP books. I'll open them up right. Go on the screen. Okay, so this is the workbook. Let's navigate through this workbook. So all of this is something which I've already, you know, mentioned. We've discussed it in the class. So this is like your essential reading for this, like a summary of your entire syllabus, which again, we've discussed. And I, in fact, discussed it in order of hierarchy as well. This is how it links with other papers. The financial management function is chapter one that we are looking at. So let's very quickly jump on to that. This again, we've discussed the CBE approach, how we're going to handle it, specific skills. Again, this is something that you can go through as part of your homework for today, because we've literally just introduced the subject today and we are just starting off with your chapter one, which is your financial management function. Let me very quickly move on to questions for this. Okay, so this is what the overall chapter overview is. So once we are actually done with it, you can move, you can actually go through this summary page. Okay, so this is what we have. All of this we've done. Okay, so very quickly, let's start off with the activity one. Very quickly, I want everybody to go through activity one on your screens and tell me the answer for it. And give me the answer for it. So B Company has just released its financial results for the year and its profits before tax increased by 38% over the previous year. This was due largely to a doubling of sales in Southeast Asia. However, the share price in B Company fell by almost 20% immediately after the profit announcement. So what is happening? Your profit after tax has increased by 38% from your previous year. However, your share price has fallen by almost 20%. So now, which of the following is the least likely explanation for the fall in share price? So which of these factors amongst the ones given would be least likely to impact your financial, you know, to be able to impact your share price? Third says Vaishnavi, second says Kushal. So just give me, everybody needs to give me an answer. Which one do you reckon is the most least likely option to impact your, you know, share price? Option B, second says most of the class, and indeed that is the correct option, because a depreciation charge was higher due to a change in the accounting policy is least likely to impact your share price, because this is something which is internal calculation to the organization. All other factors which are given here are going to immediately impact your share price. So like sales in Southeast Asia has been expected to increase by more than 100%. So if that happens, obviously, you know, there is going to be a change in the share price. The level of these company business risk is going to increase. Again, that is going to be absorbed by your share price. Delays in the launch of new products are expected in the coming year. Again, it is going to impact your share price. But however, a change in the depreciation charge because of change in the accounting policy is least likely to impact your share price in the long run. The most likely one is going to be option C. Yes, that's right. In fact, all of them would impact, but obviously, you know, varying different opportunities, you can say. So the expected future increase, you know, in risk happening definitely is going to impact your share price in the most likely form of it. Right? Any doubts? Anything anybody wants to ask here? Yes, Akash, please go ahead. Akash, you have a doubt? Okay. Anything anybody wants to ask? Is it clear with everyone? How three is most likely. So when we say that the business risk is increasing, the business is taking risk more than the risk appetite of the organization. And when that happens, definitely there is going to be an impact in the share price. If the business risk undertakes on a positive level, then it could shoot up the share price because obviously the risk that you have undertaken has worked well for you. If the business risk you've taken more than the appetite and you've not been able to cope up, then the share price is definitely going to fall. So yes, this is something which is definitely going to impact the share price. Right, Jatin? Why would a company be concerned with its share price? It gets impacted by external factors. No, it gets impacted by internal as well as external factors. Whatsoever decisions as a management you are taking, you obviously, it is going to impact the organization's share price. And that is like one, you can say, parameter of how organizations, how industry is going to judge you, because your ultimate shareholder wealth is going to be impacted by the share price of the organization. Right? Yes, absolutely right, Manish. That company definitely wants to increase its wealth, and the shareholder wealth is the wealth of the ultimate owners of the company. Right? Whose doubt was it? Let me just scroll up a little bit. Where am I? Okay, Aryan says, okay, so that's wonderful. Shall we proceed? Let's move on to the next activity. Okay, so shareholder wealth maximization, dividends, market value. This is the formula that we just did. Dividend plus change in share price is what? P1 minus P0, right? So that's a change in the share price plus the recent dividends divided by the share price at the start of the year. So this is exactly what we have. Let's very quickly go through the illustration on your screens. Okay, so there you are. I'm just going to hide the solution because I want everybody to solve this yourself and give me the correct answer. The formula is also there on the screen, just in case you obviously haven't learned it for now. So I want you to follow this formula and solve the question on the screen. Very quickly, everyone, please. Okay, so we have some answers. 24% is what I see given by Jatin, given by Aryan, Kosh, Nikhil, Hemant. Okay, so everybody seems to be giving me the answer of 24%. So can we just very quickly verify this? So what do we have here? We have dividends. A shareholder purchased 1,000 shares in SJG company on the 1st of January 2011 at a market price of 2.5 per share. At the year end, the price is 2.82. So from 2.50, it has increased to 2.82. 2.82 minus 2.50 is the change in the share price. The dividend paid during the year was 0.28. per share. So this is the dividend which has been paid divided by this price at the start, which is 2.5. So very simple, and I'm sure everybody has been able to do this. Let me also very quickly open up my Excel and do it simultaneously with you. This is just a very simple illustration to begin the concept. So don't judge your financial management paper by this. Obviously, it is the level of the questions is going to shoot up. Okay, so what do we have? So we have this Excel. Okay, so what is your P1? We need P1, we need P0, we need dividend, we need P1 again. So P1 is what, 2.82, is it? P0 was 2.50, was it? And dividend was, let me just refer back to the question again. 2.82, 2.50 and 0.28. Okay, so 0.28 is what we have. So can we just very quickly calculate our total shareholder wealth? So what is it? The formula says change in the share price, which is P1 minus P0. Minus P0 plus your dividend paid. This divided by your price at the beginning, which is 2.5. So this is 24%. So yes, indeed, 24% is the right answer. Right? Everybody okay with it? Manish, why do you write 0.60 plus 24%? Okay, so I think you're just giving me the steps away, right? So end answer for everyone is 24%. Tell me how to interpret this ratio. Yes, yes, definitely. See, we'll be doing that as well. So 24% is the increase in the shareholder wealth over the last 1 year. Considering the fact that the share price at the beginning was 2.5, now the share price is 2.82. So by calculating our total shareholder return formula, we can interpret that there has been a 24% increase in the shareholders. Right? This is how you basically talk about these numbers. Is that okay? Let's proceed towards the next question. Okay, so now there is an exam focus point given here, is that students often forget to use the start of this share price as the denominator when calculating the total shareholder return. The start of the period share price needs to be used, as the return being calculated is the return on the share price paid at the start of the period. So very important to use the formula correctly, please. Yes, everybody okay with it? There has been a total capital gain of how much? This is what your increase in share price is, from an increase from your original share price, and plus the dividend which you've been paid, which paid out, which is on the share price of the share, with the bare share price of 2.50. So this is 12.8 plus 11.2 gives you an overall increase of 24%. Right? Is that okay with everyone? So do you understand that how this 24% is basically, what does it comprise of? Right? What about others? I'm not getting an okay from everyone. If you have any doubts, please ask. This is what the calculation is like. 11.2%. Sure. So what was the dividend which was paid? The dividend paid was 0.32, right? From an overall share price of 2.50. So 0.28 divided by 2.5 gives us an increase in the dividend of 11.2%. So this is what, this is the dividend return that you've given away. So your total shareholder wealth basically comprises of two aspects, right? Okay, let me just show it to you. So this increase basically comprises of two aspects: total capital increase and total dividend. Right? So what is capital? Capital is obviously just the increase in the share price, which is 2.82 minus your 2.5. This is the increase in the share price. And obviously your denominator is what? Your denominator is your 2.5, which is the base price. So this is your total increase in the capital. Whenever we talk about dividend, we've paid a dividend of 0.28 on a share price of 2.5, so this is the increase for dividend, the total increase is this plus this, so which again takes us to the same percentage of 24%. Right, Vaishnavi? Is that okay with you now? Yes, the dividend yield formula. Wonderful. Just bear with me for a second. Right? Is that okay with everyone? Shall we proceed to the next question now? Okay, so what do we have here? We have calculation of financial objectives. We're going to now calculate this question. Let me just show it to you on your screen. So Magneto PLC has objectives to improve the earnings per share. So what is the return that you're getting per share, as well as the dividends per share by 10% per annum. So that is what your objective is, right? You've been given certain financial information. You're required to calculate the current year earnings per share. So very quickly, go through your calculations. What is the earnings per share that you have achieved? You've been given certain numbers. You need to interpret these numbers. So in current year, what is your earning? So open up your books as well, or you can start solving in Excel, because that is really the correct way. So what is your earning per share? What is available to be distributed to the shareholders, right? So what do you need to do for that? You need to take your profits after interest and tax, reduce your preference dividends that you have paid. That becomes your earnings available to be distributed to your equity shareholders. So that is your earnings available to your equity shareholders divided by the number of shares in issue. So that is how you calculate your earnings per ordinary share. So what do we have? We have 14.5 as the correct option being given by most of the students. So what do we have there? Remember, this is only towards your equity shareholders. Do not get confused. This amount here is your profit after tax, interest and tax, but you must take off your preference dividend as well. So let's solve this. In the current year, what do we have? So the current year, we have our profit after interest and tax. Which is equals to how much? Let me just have a look. 14508. From this, you need to take off your preference dividends always, remember, because we only have to find out profits attributable to equity shareholders only. Equity shareholders. So this is something which you must always remember. Let me just increase the font size a little bit. Okay, so what is my amount? How much have I given away as my dividends, preference dividend? It is 200, right? So we must always reduce this 200 to find out what the profits attributable to your equity shareholders. Then you have your number of equity shares, which is equals to how much number of equity shares are 100,000 ordinary shares you have in issue. That is 100,000. Can you find out your earning per share? Per share, remember this is only for our equity shareholders that we calculate. They are the ones who are the real owners of the company and taking the maximum risk whatsoever. So what is your earning per share? It is 14.3 that you must select. So do option 14.3 cents. Now I hope everybody is clear with what is $1. $1 is equals to 100 cents, right? So how do you interpret this? You either read it as 14 cents, or you can just write down your answers in your 14.31 cents only. Is everybody okay with it? Where are we? Let me just have a look at the chat box, because I see a few of you correct, you know, calculating the wrong answers. Okay, where are we? Let me just do a full screen. It's difficult to navigate like this. Can we use short form the exams like profit after tax, profit per equity? Yes, you can make use of generally used short forms as well. Something that the examiner will obviously be able to understand, right? So Sahil, I hope it's clear. Then who else did 14.3? Manish, Naveen, and Aryan. I hope it is clear that why is it 14.3 and not 14.5? You must take off the dividend paid to the your preference shareholders, because only then you know what is the profits which are attributable to your equity shareholders. So Naveen says all clear, wonderful. Great. I've got a yes from Sahil and Aryan as well. So I hope now everybody understands how we've actually calculated this. Great. Let's just proceed then. So what do we have? Let's proceed to the question again. So that is one part that we've done. What is the growth in the dividend per ordinary share? So now you have to tell me what is the growth in the dividend per ordinary share. So there is your data. There you are. Very quickly calculate. So what is your dividend? Dividend is given here. So from 7986, it has increased to 8583. So calculate the increase which has happened. And calculate per share increase in dividends as well. Okay, so what do we have? 8.59 says Manish. Even if you don't have the options, Kushal, you just can just tell me your answer. Let's not wait and, you know, take use of the options. You should just be able to tell me your answer. So tell me 8.59, that is 8.6 is what it is according to Manish. What about others? I want everybody to give me an answer. Right or wrong, it's completely okay. Okay, so 7.5 is what most of you are giving me the answer. So let's have a look. Dividend in the current year is 8585. Okay. Is what? It is 8585. Dividend last year was how much? 79, what was it? 7986. Okay, so it is 7986. How much has been the increase? Oops. Increase in dividend. 8586 minus 7986. So increase is 599. And this is over how much? This increase is over what period? Percent. Let's quickly have a look at what's happening in the question. Ordinary shares. And the number of shares is the same. So what do we have here? So what sort of increase have we seen? So to be able to calculate the increase, let's just take the denominator and find out the increase. So this over your base price percentage gives you the increase, which is 7.5%, right? Is that okay with everyone? How do you calculate this? So just, I'm just typing it down for you, for those who did not see the formula. So this is your increase divided by your base price, which is 7986, right? Is 7.5 okay with everyone? Why it is a 7.5% increase? What about others? I need everybody's confirmation that everybody understands this. Or if you have a query, please feel free to ask. I'll be more than happy to repeat it. Great, great. So let's move on to the next part of the question. What is the total shareholder return in the current year? So very quickly. Okay, so that's very preemptive of Manish. He's already given me the answer of 11.6. Let's wait for all your other friends to quickly do it as well. So here is the question on your screen. You need to calculate the total shareholder increase. Remember the formula we've just seen. So take out your share change in share price. Calculate the base price you know already. Dividends paid during the year you already know. So can we all calculate it? What is the base price? So your base price is 4.7 per share. Number of shares is already given. So can you just calculate this in the form of a per share value already? So let's see what the team has to say. Why we are not reducing the retained earnings from dividend earned? Retained earnings is something which has not been distributed as dividends. So why will we reduce that? Retained earnings is something which has been retained by the company, all, you know, instead of distributing it as dividends to the equity shareholders. It is retained earning in itself. That is why it will not be reduced. So I'm getting the answer of 11.6. How is it? What is the dividend per share? Dividend per share is, if I just take it in thousands already, so it is 8586. So let me just round it off to thousands. Dividend per share is your current dividend divided by, I'm just making the calculations in thousands. It's 8.59 or 8.6, you can say. What is the increase in share price? So let me just put down P0, P1. So what is the price per share? Previous year is 4.7 and this is 5.16. Okay, 4.7 and 5.16. 4.7 and 5.16 it was, right? Let me just check it from the book. 4.17 and yes. So what is the increase? Increase is obviously this minus this. So this is my increase in the share price which has happened. So this is 46 cents as we read it. Can we all calculate our total share holder return, which will be what? The increase in the share price plus your dividend, which has been paid per share, divided by your total base price, which is, let me just do it in columns, divided by total share price, which is your P0 is 4.7. What have I done? So this comes out to be how much? Didn't think I'm wrong. 8.6. And then, okay, so this is in cents that we are calculating. So this, I obviously need to put down in cents. So this is 46 cents because we are comparing cents to cents. So this comes out to be how much? Increase, the dividend per share is 8.6. 8.6 plus your 46 cents of your increase, which is 46, divided by your total share price at the beginning, which is 470, is the share price. We are just converting everything to cents again, right? Because this value is given in terms of cents. So can we just bifurcate it in increase and give the exact percentage, which comes out to be 11.6%. Okay with everyone? 11.6 is what most of you have already calculated. Manish is right. Aryan is right. Naveen is right. What about others? Is everybody okay with 11.6? Do you want me to show you the calculations again? Remember, your $1 is equals to, let's get rid of this. Your $1 is equals to 100 cents. So just compare and make sure that you are writing everything in cents. So this is 470 cents. Okay, so that's just a yes. What about others? And this is in cents as well. And that is how we just calculate the price. So in cents, as we may just call it here. What about others? Is that okay with everyone? Yes, yes, all clear. Yes, wonderful. So that's great. Now that we've done this question as well, it's time for us to go back to our notes. Okay, so this is something that we obviously know, that one of the financial objectives is to increase or maximize the profits of the organization. So obviously, as a finance manager, one of the financial objectives which will be given to you is to be able to make sure that the profits gets maximized. So the aim is to maximize the profits of the business. However, profits are not a best measure of the company's performance. Profits can be manipulated, use of provisions, capitalization of expenses. Profits does not take into account any sort of risk which is undertaking profits on their own. Take no account of the volume of investment that has been made, and profits are a short-term performance indicator. So yes, you know, there is the aim is, even though the aim is to maximize the profits, profits, however, are clearly not one of the best indicators of the company's actual performance, because clearly, you know, profits you can manipulate. It can go up and down by making use of provisions or, you know, capitalization of certain expenses which should have been capitalized instead, or, you know, should have been charged to the P&L instead. Or profits definitely do not reflect the true reflection of the amount of risk that you are undertaking. And profits on their own take no account of volume of investment. And definitely profits are only a short-term performance indicator. So yes, even though we endeavor as a financial manager to, you know, try and achieve the profits, to try and achieve, you know, maximum profit maximization, this clearly will not be the true reflection of the company's performance, right? Okay, EPS, I think we've done already. So probably that is why a few of you got it wrong in the first place, because I did not show you the formula. We just quickly jumped onto the question for it. So EPS, that is earning per share, is calculated by dividing the net profit or the loss attributable to the ordinary shareholders by the weighted average number of ordinary shares. So obviously what you do, profit after tax, always knock off the preference dividend, divide by the weighted average number of ordinary shares which are in issue in the organization. So this formula, definitely you should be able to learn and apply as well. Always remember to take off your preference dividends to find out the kind of profits which are attributable to the equity shareholders. What are the drawbacks of using this EPS? Obviously, it's historic data that you're using, right? So it's based on past data, and clearly you can be manipulating these profit figures. So it's definitely prone to manipulation as well. Question we've already done, so we have been just a little more preemptive about it. Okay, so now before I actually proceed, anybody has any doubts, anything anybody wants to ask? Because apart from these, you know, maximization of shareholders' wealth, maximization of profits, increasing the EPS in the organization, there would be few other financial targets as well, which you will be given as a financial manager, that, you know, you need to make sure that the gearing of the company, which is your intern, your debt equity ratio, is, you know, restricted. You do not go over geared in terms of being too, you know, that leverage of too much debt being taken by you should not be there. You would have certain sort of targets for profit retention, or what sort of dividends are you giving away to the shareholders. There would be targets for operating profitability, which is your return on capital employed. One thing I want to tell everyone here as homework, what you have to do is, everybody, let me just mark down your homework here. Read the briefing notes at the start of your workbook. Though I've covered everything in the PPT itself, but I want everybody to just have a good read and, you know, absorb the paper a little bit better. And everybody's homework is to revise your ratio analysis. We've all done it. This is something which will be always considered as brought forward knowledge in your FM paper. I will not be going through each and every ratio. I will not be explaining what this return on capital employed, what this gearing, you know, ratio is all about. You have to be able to do this yourself. This is something which is brought forward knowledge. This is something which is expected for you to know already. Is everybody okay with it? Is there anybody in the class who is not familiar with calculating basic ratios? Is there anybody in the class who requires help on this? Anybody? So I hope you will all do the homework which I have mentioned here. So please, very important to revise your ratio analysis. If your ratio analysis is not strong, is not good, you will not be able to pass your FM paper, because this is something which is brought forward knowledge from your MA paper already, or any other accounting paper that you've done in your life. But certainly something that you should be all familiar with. What about others? I haven't got everybody's reply on me. Is there anybody who requires extra, you know, help on being able to calculate ratios? Wonderful. So I see most of you familiar with ratio analysis, and this is definitely something which you should all be able to calculate very, very simply. Now, apart from just, you know, as a financial manager, you being given financial objectives, you will also be given certain non-financial objectives in your job role as a finance manager. Any idea? Any non-financial objectives that you can think of that will be, you know, allocated to you, that will be given to you as a finance manager? this is also like one of your objectives. This is also something that you should be looking at. Corporate social responsibility. That's right, Naveen. Social responsibilities, goodwill of the organization. That's right. What else? I mean, how do you actually incorporate these things? How do you incorporate these non-financial objectives? Pollution control. So what sort of, you know, responsibility towards the environment at large that you're taking? So yes, environmental objectives. That's yes again. What else? So what about the workforce that works for you? You know, welfare of the employees, welfare of the management per se, you know, providing the service that you're providing to the employees, to the customers at a broader perspective. Fulfillment of responsibilities towards customers, towards your suppliers, towards the society at large. Performance appraisal would be part of your welfare to the employees. Yes, absolutely right. Diversification in terms of, you know, what extra you're actually providing. Leadership in research and development as well. Quality products for customers in at reasonable prices. That's right. After sales service. Yes, so these are all different, or you know, different non-financial objectives again, which you as a finance manager would be required to take care of, would be required to, you know, oversee and make sure that, you know, your organization is actually achieving these. Right, so very quick summary or revision of the basic ratios on your screen. I want everybody to spare out 2 minutes and read these basic ratios, profitability and return ratios, like the return on capital employed. How do we calculate this? This is profit before interest and tax divided by capital employed. Capital employed is your total shareholders fund plus your long-term debts, or you could make use of the formula for total assets less your capital liabilities, right? Non-financial objectives also include some cost. Then why are we defining as non-financial? These are non-financial because this is not, obviously, see, any objective that you take up is going to involve cost. Nothing happens for free, right? But these are non-financial from the perspective that they do not give a monetary return to the organization in the form of profits. That is why they've been categorized as non-financial. Right, Naveen? Wonderful. So quickly go through these ratios on the screen. So you should all be familiar with calculating your capital employed, your return on capital employed formula, your you know, return on equity, your gross profit margins, your net profit margins. You should all be familiar with this. Quickly go through this and then we'll go through a question as well just to quickly revise on these ratios. So let's refer to your book and open up your activity, is it? Let's find out what do we have in the book. Okay. This is something that we've already covered. We'll come to this corporate governance as well. Okay, so there's one activity on corporate governance. Let's very quickly cover that as well first. Okay. Any idea what corporate governance is? So it's a way in which organizations are being told to operate. It's a way the system and processes within the organizations needs to operate. And predominantly companies which are based in the UK must follow the UK corporate governance regime. Let me very quickly show this to you. Even though you're going to cover this in like great depth in your SBL paper at the professional level, but here towards from your FM's perspective, very basic knowledge is what you're required to have on this topic. So what is corporate governance? Corporate governance is the way, the rules and the processes by which the behavior of the firm is directed. So this is what you are required to do as an organization operating in the UK or being a subsidiary of a UK run organization. Anybody's heard of SOX compliance? I don't know where you, where, you know, where each one of you are presently placed. So anybody who is familiar with SOX compliance, why is my chat box not opening up? Okay, so just one yes I have. Okay, so corporate governance predominantly is for companies which, you know, it's a way of operating, and corporate governance in itself has two ways of operating. One is a UK version of it, something that we will be studying in your paper. And then one is a US version of it, which we call as SOX, which is the Sarbanes-Oxley corporate governance regime. Now, the difference between the two is, you know, the thought process behind both of these corporate governance regimes. The rules-based regime, which is your SOX compliance, is more stringent, it's more rules-based, as we call it, whereas under your UK governance, your corporate governance is works on a comply or explain phenomena. So under the principles of this, we tell organizations how they should be operating, what are the rules, what are the processes they should be following. And if at all they do not follow these rules, they can very clearly go ahead and tell why they've not been able to comply. So it's a simple comply or explain phenomena, which is based in the UK. Now, because your ACC qualification is predominantly a UK-based qualification, here we'll be learning majorly about the UK Corporate Governance Code, which is more of a principles-based approach, which is a more flexible approach towards corporate governance, that how organizations should be complying. SOX compliance means they are the parameters which a process is required to meet. Yes, absolutely. So it is, you know, it is, you're telling that this is how an organization is supposed to be run. This is how and these rules are something that you have to comply to. Which one is more acceptable in overall market? Well, really, it depends, you know. Like I said, UK-based companies majorly follow the UK-based corporate governance, which is a principles-based approach. However, organizations based in the US follow a more stricter regime, which is the SOX compliance towards corporate governance. It is definitely more stricter in its outlook, right? Okay, now I don't want to go into the nitty-gritties of it because this is something which we will be studying at a very, you know, huge level in our SBL paper. But yes, from your F9's perspective, you must know what corporate governance is and what are the overall principles of corporate governance. So before I actually go on to the theory aspects of it, let me very quickly show you a video on this, that how it actually operates, what is it all about. And then we'll do a question on it as well. First, I want to show you what corporate governance is actually. It's the way businesses operate themselves. It's the way you're supposed to run an organization. So we'll do a very small one. Let me share the link with you. This is the overall link. Let me just add on the subtitles just in case you're not able to hear it properly. I hope the sound is also on. Share sound is on. Okay, wonderful. So you should all be able to hear it as well. So very quick one on this.
Welcome to this webinar, which will tell you absolutely everything that you could ever possibly need to know about corporate governance. So let's begin with the definition. Corporate governance is the system by which a company is directed and controlled. It contains three critical words: system, directed, and controlled. As with all systems, it is essential to keep focused on the objective of corporate governance. And the objective is actually quite simple. It is to make better decisions. Corporate governance is not simply a regulatory compliance issue, but in effect, corporate governance actually enables the business to be more successful through better decision making. The key to the effectiveness of corporate governance in an organization is the flow of information. For example, it's critical that the right information gets to the right people at the right time. There are also, of course, dangers associated with information. Not enough or inaccurate information leads to ill-informed decisions, whilst too much information means you can lose focus on what is actually supposed to be important. So apply the less is more principle, but do so with care. The most common serious failure is ineffective follow-up of decisions made. Therefore, agenda item number one in any committee must have two clear elements. Have we done what we have said we would do, and did it work? Only when you can answer yes to both of these questions can the item be considered dealt with effectively. Other critical areas relating to the success of corporate governance include challenging the decisions and recording of the challenges made, simplicity so that the system is both accessible and easily understood, and finally, honesty, making sure that people feel confident enough to actually state their mind. So, sorry about my comment at the beginning of this session when I said you'd learn everything you needed to know, but at least you've made a start. Bye for now.
Yes, absolutely. Corporate governance is a much, much wider term and certainly cannot be learned in a span of, 2 minutes, 10 seconds this video is all about. Okay. So yes, this is what corporate governance is all about. We're talking about how businesses are required to work, you know, how they are required to operate in an organization. So like I said, it's a principles-based, principles-based approach. So let's quickly have a look at what does it talk about. So it brings into the picture a lot of, your independence of the directors. So I'll give you a very simple example just to set the tone of this. Let me just go back to this. Then I'll show you this one as well. Okay, so there was more ratios to be shown, but what I'll do, I'll just share this link with you so that we can go through the activity first. So what is it going to be all about? We're talking about corporate governance, how businesses operate themselves. Like I said, the UK version is more flexible. It's more principles-based. So it tells organizations that how they should be operating themselves. Let's go back to your books. So it predominantly focuses on a lot of, unfettered, you can say, power being given into the hands of one person. So very strongly it says that the board of directors should have two separate heads. There should be one managing director and then there should be one chairman in the organization as well. There is definitely, we're talking about board of directors. There's significant percentage of the board consisting of non-executive directors, which is the non-executive directors, the part-time directors who monitor the actions of the executive. NEDs should be independent, 3-year contract, no share options should be there. So yes, these are just broad some of the guidelines. You need not learn them in your FM paper per se. Just broadly understand what is the essence of the word of corporate governance and how does it actually come to the picture, because we're bringing on a lot of independence of your non-executive directors, a lot of committees being formed by organizations like the remuneration committee, the audit committee, the nominations committee, which it like majorly talks about and how businesses should be operating. So that is very broadly what corporate governance is for you. Do not go any deeper than this, because at your SBL paper, this is like what more would be required. So just very quickly go through the activity on your screens. Very quickly, I'm looking for your answers. So what do we have? Third, that is one only. Okay, so that is what most of you have selected. Let's quickly go through the question. The following statements have been made about corporate governance. Sound system of corporate governance involves the establishment of risk management and internal control procedures for the organization. Definitely, yes. Good corporate governance requires the organization to always act in an ethically acceptable manner, even if that is contrary to the law. No, definitely not. Executive director should be paid for his services to the organization in order to keep him independent. No, that is actually not true, because a non-executive director, that is an NED, is something which doesn't pay for the services being provided. The NEDs are brought on the board just to be able to get their expertise, and they are completely independent of the organization. So they will not have any financial, you can say, you know, return being paid back to them. So definitely only the first option is correct. Let's see. Okay, so yes, only the first option is correct. Let me just put that. So only statement number one is correct. One only is the right option. So very rightly identified by everyone. Again, I'm reiterating, please do not go any deeper than this for corporate governance, because this will be something which will be required at your, at your SBL level. Okay, so why do you think we are getting this? I'll just ask a very simple question here. Who is the real owner of the organization? Who are the owners of the organization? Tell me. The shareholders, right? So shareholders are the real owners. The equity shareholders are the real owners of the organization. Who manages the organization on a day-to-day level? Who manages the organization on a day-to-day level? The management, the directors of the company, right? Clear. Right. Do you think the directors of the company, they are not the owners of the company, right? They are just only acting as agents of the real owners of the organization, who are the shareholders of the organization. So clearly what we see that there is a company which is owned by someone else, but is being operated by someone else. And this someone else who's operating the company, that is the directors of the company, are only agents of the organization who is operating the organization, who is literally like the owner of the organization, right? So there is clearly two different set of people who are owning and who are managing the organization. So there is going to be an agency gap, as we call it, because the agents, who the directors, who are acting as agents of these shareholders of the organization, will have different goals as opposed to the real owners of the organization, who are the shareholders, right? That is something which is like an obvious thing that is going to be there, because there is going to be different objectives of these two different set of people who are involved in the organization. That is what we call as an agency gap. Now, how do I actually bridge on this agency gap? Any idea? Okay, let me just ask you a quick question on this first. What is the objective of the shareholders of the organization? What do they want? What is their overall goal from the organization? To be able to maximize shareholder wealth, right? Yes. What do you think will be the objective of a director of the organization who doesn't own the organization, but is just, you know, acting as agent of the organization? So what would be the overall objective of the director of the organization? A better pay, a higher remuneration, to maximize his own wealth. Absolutely rightly identified. So now we clearly see that there are two different sets of people operating the organization with different goals, right? For an organization to perform better, what we need to do is to be able to have this goal congruence. What we need to do is to be able to align the objectives of the agents, that is the directors, with the objectives of the directors of the organization. So that is what is required, which is goal congruence, right? So how do you think we can bring that about? How do you bring about this goal congruence? Audit will only just, you know, make sure that I am doing my job well, the figures that I'm presenting are true and fair, but it will not actually align me as a director to work for the betterment of the shareholder. General meetings, by giving them appropriate incentives. That's right, Himesh. ESOP options, absolutely good option. monetary motivation, share-related payments. Yes, so these are certain incentive schemes that we can incorporate to be able to align the goals of the shareholders with the objectives of the overall shareholder. So let's make them shareholders only by giving them share options. So this ESOP scheme that we have, the employee stock option scheme, definitely in turn makes the management, the employees, the directors, the owners of the organization. When that happens, what are you then overall looking at? Making sure that the share price instead is, the share market, the shareholder wealth is maximized, because now you yourself are a shareholder as well. Right? And definitely we can make use of performance related pay so that, the directors take home their rewards depending upon how the organization has performed. So very, very important is to be able to incorporate these incentive schemes for the organization to be able to clear and narrow down on this agency gap. Okay, so this is something which I've actually identified in another chapter, but this is just being covering here. So let me just take care of this part here itself while we are working on this chapter only. So is everybody okay with the agency gap and the corporate governance? Is everybody okay with it? Great. So now you need to tell me the different types of stakeholders. Or let me just very quickly show you a good video on this as well. Because, and please do not go any deeper than this, because clearly it is something which is not part, which is not required at F9 level. This is something that we'll be doing in huge detail in your SBL paper. I also happen to be the trainer for SBL paper as well. So I know how it gets tested in your SBL syllabus. Right? Okay, so let me just tell you agency gap under corporate governance. Yes, we can have a look at this. Just looking for a good video. This is good. Just talking about the agency problem and literally how are we solving it as well. I'm sharing the link with you. One quick thing I want to check with you before I actually click on to it. In all my previous sessions, I have been showing these videos and everybody in the class has been finding them as value additions, because when you not just only hear things, but you see things through a video as well, the concepts get better understood and is retained by the students as well for a longer time. So that's precisely why I personally like showing these videos. If at all you feel, this is something which is not required, I can completely do away with these in the class. So, just let me know whether you want me to continue to show you these, value adding videos, or do you just only want to stick to your traditional way of studying? Let me know, please. Okay, Dipanj says a yes. Shweta also says a yes. Because that's what I personally feel as well. Because once you, see a relevant video on it clearly, definitely it becomes more value retaining for the student as well. Okay, so I think I've got a go ahead from everyone. So this is the link I'm sharing with you on the group, on the chat box, also switching on the subtitles so that you can read also, just in case the accent is not very clear.
Hey guys, welcome to Derek Business Class. In this video, I'm gonna explain to you a common problem happens in the corporations called agency problem. For sole proprietorships or partnerships, the management and the owners are usually the same group of people. The management runs the business to satisfy its own goals, needs, and financial requirements. Usually, there would be no conflict or less conflict. However, when a company moves from private to public ownership, the management and the owners are now two different groups of people. This is what we call an agency relationship.
The shareholders hire managers to run the company. Shareholders are the principals. They are the boss of the company. Managers are the agents of the company. So, managers are representing the shareholders to run the business. That's why there is agency problem. Because the management and the owners are two different groups of people. Management is supposed to work for the best interest of all shareholders, but it may not be the case all the time. There is conflict of interest between principal and agent. To ensure managers work for the best interest of the shareholders, the company has to pay for the agency cost. Agency cost arises from agency problems that are borne by shareholders, represents a loss of shareholder wealth. This is to maintain a corporate governance structure that minimizes agency problems. Whenever a manager owns less than 100% of the firm's equity, a potential agency problem exists. In theory, managers would agree with shareholder wealth maximization. However, managers are also concerned with their personal goals and needs, such as high salary, allowance, bonus, job security, good working environment, and flexible working hour. But what the shareholders want would be high share price, high dividend, and high profit. Do you see that? What shareholders want are different from what managers want. This would cause the managers to act in ways that do not always benefit the firm's shareholders. To solve agency problem, first, the company may implement management compensation plans. Incentive plans tie management compensation to share price. Managers will be rewarded if the share price goes up. For example, the granting of stock options. Managers are given a special right to purchase the company's shares at a predetermined price within a stipulated period, usually a cheaper price, for the managers that receive stock options as their bonus reward. Now, they become the shareholders of the company. Most likely, they will put an effort to work their best to make the share price go up so that they can earn the best return from the stock options. Another similar management compensation plan is performance plan. Performance plans tie management compensation to EPS, or growth in EPS. EPS is earnings per share, something related to share price as well. If the managers can hit the targeted EPS, reward the managers with shares or cash bonuses. These plans can help align the needs of managers and shareholders so that managers are working for the shareholders' benefits and their own benefits at the same time. The second method to solve agency problem is by market forces. Shareholder activism. Through executing voting power, shareholders participate in activities that can change the corporation. For example, if the shareholders are not happy with the existing management, during annual general meeting, they can elect new board of directors. Strong and independent BOD can engage in dismissing ineffective top management, who causes agency problems. BOD can also replace poorly performing managers. Shareholder activism is usually done by the large institutional investors, who hold large amount of shares. So, institutional investors play an important role in shareholder activism. It is because they have more power to place pressure on the management to take actions and to maximize shareholder wealth. The third method to solve agency problem is by threat of takeover. This is an external force from outsiders. When a firm's internal corporate governance structure is unable to keep agency problems in check, it is likely that rival managers will try to gain control of the firm as they look for companies that are poorly managed and undervalued. These rival managers from other companies are the potential acquirers. The threat of takeover by another firm, which is believed to enhance the troubled firm's value by restructuring its management, operations, and financing, can provide a strong source of external corporate governance. Simply speaking, in order to prevent the company to be taken over by other competitors, the management will have to work properly for the benefits of shareholders, so that agency problem can be solved because of the threat from competitors. The last part for this video, we will talk about the role of business ethics. Ethical behavior means doing the right thing. But Different people define right thing in a different way. Something that is right for me may not be right for you. That's why a set of rules or laws is used to define the right thing. Everyone has to follow the rules or laws. Some examples of unethical behaviors, such as misleading financial forecast, insider trading, fraud, excessive executive compensation, and bribery. Companies should avoid unethical behaviors because negative publicity often leads to negative impacts on a firm. All right, that's all for this video. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one. Bye.
Okay, so now we know what corporate governance helps resolve the agency problem and how it helps resolve the agency problem as well. Let me just go back. So what do we have? Okay, so this is something that we've done. Now let's understand what are the different types of stakeholders that we have. Any idea? So what do you understand by the term stakeholder? Who is a stakeholder in the first place? Any ideas from the class? What do you understand by the term stakeholder? Who is a stakeholder? The customers, the vendors, the shareholders. Yes, so everybody who gets impacted by the decisions of the organization, not only just the shareholders, is categorized as a stakeholder. People affected by the business, that's right. It includes the shareholders, it includes the management, it includes the workers, it includes society at large. It includes, you know, it even includes the government, it includes your customers, it includes your suppliers. It's going to include, you know, include your the trade unions. It is going to include the environmental groups that you have. It is going to include, you know, include even your you know, remote species that you have in the ocean per se. If you're dumping your waste in the ocean, you are definitely impacting the life of these you know, these ocean animals. So that is also your stakeholder. So this is what the stakeholder term actually means, and how do you categorize these stakeholders into different categories? Stakeholders can be internal to the organization. So internal stakeholders like the staff and the managers, so people who are working within the organization. Your connected stakeholders will include people from where, no, who are not internal to the organization, but you need them, you liaise with them to be able to get your things done. So like a finance provider, the customers, the suppliers, these are all connected stakeholders to the organization. And definitely you have your external stakeholders, people who are external to the organization, like the government, their trade unions, the pressure groups, who are not providing you with anything to, you know, to run your organization. Like the connected stakeholders, like not your customers or your suppliers, but people who are external third parties, but still get impacted, or you do get impacted by these stakeholders, right? Everybody understands what a stakeholder is and how we can categorize these stakeholders. Definitely every stakeholder will have certain expectation from the organization, right? So they will want, like the staff is going to want what? Staff will want like higher salaries, bonuses being paid, good work-life balance, whereas the customers will want, you know, good quality products being sold at a good value. The suppliers would want timely payment of their supplies. So every stakeholder per se has a different, you can say, you know, level of interest, as well as a different level of power in the organization. And as a manager, you should be able to know how to manage these different conflicting stakeholders' interests or pressures that you are facing. So you should be able to manage these stakeholders at different levels, right? Everybody okay with it? Now, this is something that we've again done. So this is where we were basically talking about certain financial performance measures. We did your profitability. These are the basic ratios that you should all be familiar with. So how do you look at these ratios? What these ratios are is something that you should all be familiar with. So profitability ratios, debt ratios, liquidity ratios, shareholder investor ratios. I'm very quickly going to revise all of these with you. And then we're going to move on to a question practice. So what do we have here? We've done the basic profitability and return ratios. Let me just go on a full screen. We have various debt and gearing ratios, liquidity ratios, shareholder investment ratios. This is just to refresh your memory. I'm showing it to you on your screens. Very quickly go through these. Very quickly go through these. Everybody okay with it? Everybody okay with these ratios? Because I'll be giving you a question for practice as homework. Just to revise your concepts. But before that, let's understand that there are different types of organizations that we have, right? Not all organizations are working towards profit maximization. There is a set of organizations which is called a not-for-profit organizations. We've all heard of these trusts, these NGOs, whose primary function, whose primary objective is to provide a service, right? And their parameter, their, you know, their judgment should obviously not be made on the basis of their profits earned, because purely they are operating, their, you know, core objective itself is just not to earn profits. They are there to provide a service, which is to the maximum number of people, really. So that is what a not-for-profit organization is, really. So not-for-profit of organizations, the objective of public sector organizations is to provide the service for which the organizations was established. The objectives of this would include the usage maximization, client satisfaction, as well as social benefit, as we put it. So that is the overall objective of the organization. That how am I basically looking at these objectives? Am I able to provide maximum good to the maximum number of people? Am I able to provide that service which I'm providing to the maximum number of people for their betterment, for their, you can say, you know, upliftment? Client satisfaction, extremely important. Remember, the parameters on which we judge our not-for-profit organization is the three E's of not-for-profit organization. So economy, efficiency, and effectiveness is what, you know, how we can basically judge their performance criteria. So that is for not-for-profit organizations. So what is it? The criteria to understand, the criteria to measure the performance of not-for-profit organizations is what value for money has the organization been able to provide. Value for money has three criteria, three E's of it that we call the economy, efficiency, and effectiveness of a not-for-profit organization. What does it talk about? What do you understand by the term economy? Any idea? What do you understand by the term economy? Tell me. What do you understand by the term economy? We're looking to minimize your input cost. So getting running that operations at the bare minimum cost. Right, Jatin? So that is what you call, you know, the criteria of economy is all about. What do you understand by the term efficiency? Have you been able to create maximum output at the bare minimum input level? So that is what is called efficiency. How efficiently you've been able to manage your operations. Are we able to maximize the output at the, you know, and at the time keeping the input really at a low, as low as practical, you know, ratio. That is what is called efficiency. And effectiveness in turn basically means that whether you've been effective enough to be able to achieve the organization's overall objective for which it stands. So for any not-for-profit organization, obviously it is running for a cause, right? So how effectively have you been able to achieve that cause is what is called the effectiveness of the organization. Everybody okay with these terms? We don't have to go much deeper into this. Just understand that if it's a not-for-profit organization we're talking about, these are the criteria we will be judging the performance of the organization upon. right? Does everybody understand this? Any doubts? Okay, because this is something that we've just quickly run up on. What about others? I've only got Naveen's confirmation for now. Okay, great. Let's now understand. We just did this a little preemptively from the book only, but this is what stakeholders are all about. These are the different types of stakeholders that we have. This is what their objectives from the organization would be, that obviously equity shareholders would want maximum wealth maximization. Directors would be looking at their own remuneration, their own power. Employees would be looking at, you know, what sort of return are they getting? What sort of job security are they getting? And creditors would be looking at, you know, getting timely payments. Community at large will be looking at what sort of issues, what sort of environmental and social impact are you giving to the society at large? So definitely every stakeholder will have its own set of expectation from the organization, something that we've just done. Agency problem is also, again, something that we've just done. I don't know why, but the book and the notes seems to be a little overlapping, probably because I made the notes earlier and the book has now been revised. But this is something that we've just covered, right? So agency problem, okay with everyone? How do we solve this? We need to obviously align the goals, right? So this is again something that we've just done, getting managerial reward systems in place. Overall benefits, again, something that we've just done. The drawbacks, yes, again, that we've done. Okay, so this is where the corporate governance part of it now kicks in. But before that, this is something that we've just already done. So this is something that we now know that, you know, it's an overall way of managing and running the organization. Looking at what is required, best practices, again, something that we've just done already. Is there anything that anybody wants me to repeat here? Because we've done it from the book already. So that's why I'm not showing it on the PPT, but exactly the same concept we've just covered in the book itself. Anything anybody wants me to cover? Stock exchange listing requirements obviously covers the fact that as a UK listed organization, listed on the UK, on the London Stock Exchange, you have to comply to certain regulations. Like for similarly in India, organizations which are listed on the Stock Exchange, on the Bombay Stock Exchange, or the National Stock Exchange, have to comply to which is the listing body, which is the regulatory body for stock exchange, the SEBI. That's right, Kushan Jatin. So similarly, organizations which are listed on the London Stock Exchange must comply to the UK Corporate Governance Code as well as to the listing requirements of the stock exchange, right? Okay, so that literally finishes off this part. No, you don't have to learn this. These are just concepts that you must learn. There is nothing to learn in this really. I mean, once you understand that, okay, you know, this is something that you, how organizations are managed and run, you just understand what corporate governance is and why it has come in place. It has come in place because of the agency problem, which is there. Right, everyone? Because I just want to show you and give to you this question for your homework practice. This is the question that you all have to do as part of your homework. In fact, I'll just give you 5 minutes now. I'll give you 10 minutes now to try and do this yourself. And then we shall cover it in the class. So very quickly, I'm sharing because I understand that most of you do not actually have the books on you as of now. So the question says that you need to review Robertson's performance by calculating the return on capital employed, the interest cover, as well as the total shareholder return. This is your question. This is the requirement of the question as well on your screens. I'm giving everyone 10 minutes to try and do this yourself because I understand most of you probably don't have the books on you. So very quickly, we know the ratios. Let's just very quickly revise our ratios. So this is your current work that you everybody has to do right now. Okay, let's wait for others to quickly calculate. So you have to calculate the return on capital employed, the interest cover, as well as the total shareholder return. I want everybody to do this. Return on capital employed and total shareholder return. So Vaishnavi, return on capital employed uses total shareholder return to be able to calculate return on capital employed. Go back and revise the formulas. Or if you want, I can very quickly show it to you as well. Where am I? Let me go back to the formula sheet. So return on capital employed uses the total shareholder return to be able to calculate the return on capital employed. There you are. So return on capital employed is your profit before interest and tax divided by your capital employed, which capital employed is in turn your shareholders' funds plus your long-term debt. Or you could just make use of the formula for your total assets and less your capital liabilities on it. Right, Vaishnavi? Is that okay? Is that okay, Vaishnavi? I want everybody to revise all your ratios today. So this is just a quick question. I wanted to, you know, for you to judge yourself at what more areas you really need to revise upon. Wonderful. Okay, so we will start with solving this question tomorrow. For those of you who have not been able to finish it off, please just very quickly finish off this question. And for the others who have done it, this shall end your session and I shall see you guys tomorrow now. And we shall start with solving this question itself. Right? So apart from this question, go back and revise your ratio analysis, please. Again, I am mentioning the homework. Yes, tomorrow timing is same. So it is going to be from 12 p.m. to 5 p.m. Saturday, Sunday. Timings shall remain the same always. Right. So everybody knows the homework now. The PPT will be shared on Monday. I will ask the TPR, the concerned team, to share the notes with you all. Right. Is there anything anybody would like me to change in the way I'm teaching? Anything anybody would like, you know? I'm always open for any suggestions for improvisation. Please let me know if there's anything that you would like me more to do, or probably less of something, more of something, any good, bad, or ugly, anything that you would like to share. Okay, wonderful. So I shall see you guys tomorrow at 12 p.m. and we shall start with this question first. Right? Okay, thank you so much, guys. Thank you. Bye-bye.